Alex Jones here with huge breaking news. Hillary Clinton, in her own words, in FBI testimony released today, told the FBI that she had amnesia, didn't remember the emails, the servers, any of it. In her own words, she says she is unfit to be president. These things are predictable, but it's still hard to believe that the FBI has been pressured for months to release their research data dump on Hillary Clinton. Because even if they're going to roll over and not charge her for the crime she's publicly committed, they should at least release them. So now, with Labor Day coming up and having this holiday on Friday, they predictably release the data dump at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, knowing that Americans are busy going to pick their kids up after school and to get ready for the long three-day weekend. A lot of what's in the data dump we've already seen, but tons of it is new. We knew about 33,000 emails that she never turned over that disappeared. That was already admitted. Now they admit to 17,500 emails that they said weren't there, that they'd previously denied to give over, that were on the servers. So they basically gave the FBI this needle in a haystack and hoped they wouldn't notice that a lot of it was hiding in plain view. But here's the big news from the FBI, and it's on screen for TV viewers. Hillary Clinton, over and over and over again, dodged subpoenas, wouldn't testify to Congress, wouldn't talk to the FBI, wouldn't answer their questions. And it was even in the news at the time in 2013. Where is she? She's in the hospital for almost a year. Well, now the FBI has gone public and said that Hillary Clinton told them years ago, and then again recently, that because she had a traumatic brain injury, a concussion, she had amnesia and didn't remember. This is so huge, because this is what Matt Drudge for 3 years has been saying. It's what Obama's former doctor is saying. It's what Dr. Drew got fired for saying. It's what my guests like Dr. Steve Pachinik have been saying. Hillary Clinton clearly has neurological problems. Donald Trump comes out and says she's having to take naps all the time. She only gives a few speeches a week. She's low energy. This is not presidential material. WikiLeaks shows that she was trying to get drugs for Parkinson's. It goes on and on. The weird seizure-like behavior, they're being helped up by Secret Service, her doctor coming over with a tranquilizer pen saying, it's okay when somebody yells something in the crowd. This woman is clearly a basket case a lot of the time and is having serious problems. And the word is she had brain surgery multiple times during that year in the hospital that overlapped 2012-2013. They've not released her full medical records. They've released only a snippet from an earlier doctor in New York. So this is such a big deal that Hillary Clinton, not Donald Trump, not Alex Jones, not Matt Drudge, not Breitbart, not World Net Daily, not Vladimir Putin, not the Keebler Elves, because we're all told this is a theory from Vladimir Putin and we're all getting orders. Hold on. Putin, what do I say? Okay, I'll say it right now. No, you look like hell. You've been in the hospital. You're falling down. You've got all these problems. You're in the hospital for a year. And now you, Hillary Clinton, told the FBI that you couldn't remember anything you did because you had such a serious brain injury. You need to be evaluated by an outside group of independent, nonpartisan brain surgeons, neurologists, and others, just as we've been calling for 6 months. You need to actually debate Donald Trump and not just have back-to-back discussions with him like's coming up in the first meeting. And you need to be held accountable for being caught having classified material on your servers you lied about. The FBI's come out now and released the evidence. FBI's Hillary email probe found evidence of effort to evade federal records law. That's what made the head of the EPA have to step down 3 years ago, was having a fake set of records as well. You have absconded from the law, you've been caught, and it's time for the crime syndicate you represent, the Bush and Clinton crime family, to ride into the sunset. If you don't, it's pretty clear that your health's going to catch up with you, the law's going to catch up with you, and public opinion has already caught up with you. You've been caught red-handed. More stories and analysis at InfoWars.com. If you're watching or listening to this transmission, you are the resistance.
Whoa. Isn't it funny? You know, when I came here 17 years ago and I said that I wanted to lead a campaign to get Britain to leave the European Union, you all laughed at me. Well, I have to say, you're not laughing now, are you? I come to you from the United Kingdom with a message of hope and a message of optimism. It's a message that says if the little people, if the real people, if the ordinary decent people are prepared to stand up and fight for what they believe in, we can overcome the big banks. We can overcome the multinationals. We saw the commentariat and we saw the polling industry doing everything they could to demoralize our campaign. On the day of the vote itself, that morning, they put us 10 points behind. And actually, they were all wrong. And they were wrong because what the Brexit campaign did is we reached those people who've been let down by modern global corporatism. We reached those people who have never voted in their lives, but believe by going out and voting for Brexit, they could take back control of their country, take back control of their borders, and get back their pride. Folks, the message is clear. The parallels are there. There are millions of ordinary Americans who've been let down, who've had a bad time, who feel the political class in Washington are detached from them, who feel so many of their representatives are politically correct parts of that liberal media elite. They feel people aren't standing up for them, and they've actually, in many cases, given up on the whole electoral process. And I think that you have a fantastic opportunity here with this campaign. You can go out. You can beat the pollsters. You can beat the commentators. You can beat Washington.
And now he joins us to the bottom of the hour, Nigel Farage, a major historical figure, just a normal businessman, a family man who 25 years ago saw their sovereignty being destroyed, didn't get elected to office until 99, now the fastest growing party, not just in the UK, but Europe. And it's just classic Renaissance, Magna Carta, 1776, whatever you want to call it. It's amazing to have been interviewing this guy for 15 years. It's been a few years since he's been able to come on. He joins us to talk about all of this, but the parallels between he and Donald Trump, where Trump's never been in office either, are simply amazing. We're going to talk about it all. Here's the Washington Post, Financial Times, and others today saying, with globalization in danger, G20 double down and are trying to defeat nationalism. They say if Hillary is defeated, it's the end of the New World Order. This is an epic time. Mr. Farage, who just recently resigned as the head of UKIP, still in the EU Parliament. Wow, talk about a David versus Goliath story. This is epic.
Well, it is. And I think the point about Brexit, Alex, is Brexit is the first victory. We've had little victories. We've had, you know, the odd election that's gone well for people in, whether it's in Germany or France or wherever it may be. But Brexit is the first strike back against this phenomenon of the big banks, the big businesses, effectively owning politics, literally willfully destroying nation-state democracy, getting rid of that thing that our forebears actually fought and shed their blood to create and to preserve, our liberties, our freedoms, all of that being taken away, and suddenly, in a referendum that no one said we could win. I mean, literally, nobody thought Brexit would succeed, and we've done it. We've done it, and I think what we've done is given inspiration to freedom fighters right across the Western world.
Wow. Where should we begin in the limited time we have here, Mr. Farage? The election here, how Brexit...
Yeah. Well, let's talk about Hillary, shall we?
Please do.
If you can bear it. I mean, Hillary represents everything that has gone wrong in our lives in the last couple of decades. She is part, a dynastic part, you know, of that class of people who have taken us into an endless series of foreign wars that I think arguably have made things worse, certainly in Libya and elsewhere, not better. She is part of that phenomenon where all that seems to matter now is corporatism. You know, the big global companies who want to set the rule books to effectively put out of business small and medium-sized competitors, they have destroyed, you know, what I believe to be proper free market capitalism, where you or I can go and set up a company you know, and have a real chance of succeeding. And they presided over a period where the rich have got richer and where ordinary, decent, working people have seen their living standards deteriorate. She represents failure. And she, of course, is completely unreconciled to the vote on Brexit, because Hillary loves the European Union. She loves these supranationalist global-type bodies. In fact, I think she sees the European Union as a prototype for an even bigger form of world government. And I would just say this to people. You know, I condemned Obama when he came to the United Kingdom during our referendum. He looked down his nose at Britain and the British people. He told us that if we dared to vote for our independence and our democracy, that America would basically throw us off the edge of a cliff. Forget about everything we've done and shared together, you know, over these last few years. And I condemned Obama for doing that. So I'm not going to tell people how they should vote in the USA, but let me make it clear. If you want nothing to change at all, if you want to continue with the kind of cronyism that we see with the Clinton Foundation and everything else, if you want things to stay the same, you vote for Hillary. But if you think there's an opportunity here, particularly in the wake of Brexit, for us to start doing things differently in the Western world, then she's the last person you should vote for. And I said at the Mississippi rally, I said, I wouldn't vote for Hillary if you paid me. I said, actually, I wouldn't vote for Hillary if she paid me. And I feel pretty strong. And I feel pretty strongly about that.
Well, I mean, it's come out in the new WikiLeaks documents, which she admits are accurate, that she's actually was selling influence to the Chinese president. I mean, this is even beyond espionage. I don't know how she and speaking of the devil, George Soros has tried to crash your country as well and did crash the pound. If you look at this, he wants the internet to be run by the United Nations and basically the EU. He's come out now and said he wants the UN to run our police. And people laugh at that, but the UK got brought into the European Union without ever having a vote. These things are done by stealth. It's a real warning, I think, to the United States.
Oh, yes, it happens incrementally, little piece by little piece. You know, we joined just over 40 years ago. We joined something that my parents' generation were told, don't worry your little heads. This is just about trade. It's just about jobs. It's just about being friendly with our neighbors. And bit by bit, you know, we finished up in a situation where 75% of our laws weren't even made in the Houses of Parliament. They were made in the European institutions. We finished up with a system where under the European arrest warrant, any British citizen could be extradited to Greece or Bulgaria or anywhere else without the production of prima facie evidence, which, you know, from the country that actually developed Magna Carta, it really is quite a surrender. And we finished up, you know, we finished up being banned from making our own trade relationships and our own formal relationships with any other country in the world. And it's like, the analogy, Alex, I've been given, it's like if you get a lobster, right?
Yes.
And you chuck it into a pan of hot water, it will shriek and shout and try and get out because it knows something bad's happening.
They actually shriek. Yes, they yell.
Oh, they do. No, they really do. But if you put a lobster into cold water, right, and turn on the heat, actually what happens is the lobster just gently falls asleep and finishes up being cooked. And I think that's what happened to the United Kingdom. We were put into cold water back in 1973.
You thought it was a hot tub and you went to sleep and woke up in an EU tyranny.
Yeah, and I, you know, I was one of those people who 25 years ago, and I don't know quite how or why, but 25 years ago, I started looking at this and I just said, this is wrong.
By the way, you know, Nigel, you don't like to talk about yourself, but this is a part of history. You were a successful business guy, your family guy, whole nine yards. It's been in the news. They've taken the bolts off your car's tires. Even the French police said, looked like they tried to kill you. Your airplane crashed, all this stuff. I mean, what made you 25 years ago decide to just strike out by yourself and now epically change the world? I mean, it's a success story for everybody out there.
It's actually very simple. Very, very simple indeed. You know, in every town, in every village in my country, there are memorials, war memorials, to those that fell, both in the First and Second World Wars, fighting for us to stay as an independent, free, proud democratic nation and to stop tyranny in Europe. And I felt that what the European project was becoming was the very kind of tyranny that those before us had fought to stop. And nobody was asking me or telling me I had to put on a military uniform and carry a rifle. All I had to do was get involved and form a political party and get people to support it. And I've never wavered from that view in 25 years.
The information war, Nigel Farage, incredible. We've only got about 10 minutes left with you before we do another interview.
Yeah.
You've resigned from the party, but you're still in the EU Parliament. You're still working hard. Can you just briefly, for folks that want to know, explain, I mean, I understand, but after 25 years, why you've pulled back right on the, I mean, after this huge victory.
Yeah, well, there are two reasons. One is that there are two different types of people in politics. There are those who want to be something, who want the title, who want the chauffeur-driven car, who want the, you know, grandiose sort of stage to be on. But there are other people in politics because they're in it for a purpose. And my specific purpose was to free my country from this European project. So having achieved that goal, I said, look, I'm not retiring. I'm not moving up into the mountains and living in a, you know, living in a tin shed. But I'm going to step back from leadership, and that's going to leave me free to make this argument not just in the United Kingdom, not just in the EU Parliament, but around other parts of the Western world. And when you and I met each other in Cleveland at the Republican Convention, that was the first time in years I'd been free without having to represent a political party to go out and look around the world. And I will, you know, as I'm talking to you tonight, I will make these arguments in the American elections, and I will go around the free world saying to people, let's take back what we've lost. The second reason, if I'm frank, is that doing this for a quarter of a century, doing a job that absorbs you 24/7,
it's exhausting.
Leaves you no time to catch a fish, leaves you no time to see your kids grow up. I'm now going to work, Alex, 50 or 60 hours a week, not 100 hours a week.
I get it, sir. I totally understand, and thank God you created UKIP. I mean, you're a model. I mean, everything else. Look at how every EU country has a major Brexit-style movement, and the polls show that we're going to see huge victory here. So I want to talk about that in a moment, how the empire is going to strike back, how the socialists and communist bureaucrats and mega banks are going to strike back. But getting into overall what globalism is up to these days, are they crying foul and saying that they're in deep trouble as a way to get governments to desperately go along with them? Or is it accurate that they're on their heels? I mean, I've got a stack of news articles here saying U.S.-led globalism is dying. And, of course, they mean globalist-run globalism is dying.
Yeah.
With the TPP. Yeah. New World Order in trouble. Soros in trouble. I mean, they claim they're in really, really deep trouble. And I look at the facts. It looks like they are. But then I ask, how are they going to bring us into a depression? Are they going to crash our currencies again? I mean, this is the usual suspects. How is the empire going to strike back?
The empire is bewildered. The empire is befuddled. The empire still cannot, just as I said about Hillary earlier in this interview, the empire doesn't get Brexit because the empire didn't believe Brexit was possible. And now the empire's problem is that it's fighting this argument on several fronts at once. You know, we've got the American elections going on. We've got a big referendum coming up in Hungary on migrant quotas from Germany. We've got a rerun of the Austrian presidency where the right-wing candidate was cheated by false votes. So they've got a real problem. They are fighting us now on a whole series of fronts. What will they do to fight back? I don't know the answer to that yet. And do you know something? Nor do they. Because over the course of the last few decades, all of their plans, piece by piece, to build these new structures, they've won every single battle. Some of them have taken them longer than they wanted, but they've won every single battle. After Brexit, they're in trouble. And I have to say that these American elections, you know, this could be a result globally far bigger even than Brexit. You know, if America is the leader of the Western world, once again becomes the leader of the free world, well, then I think, we would have done away with the globalists.
Well, sir, you're right. The Washington Post said 2 weeks ago that Hillary's referendum and that Brexit was the first domino and that she's the second, and if she falls, they say it's irrevocable because they, in their own documents that we've gotten from BAMP Canada, North American Union meetings 10 years ago, they admit, they say, it's key that we maintain stealth and secrecy. If the public ever finds out, North American integration and our plan will fail. That's a quote. I mean, it's like a James Bond villain. We've caught them. You've exposed them. I don't see how they can continue when it comes out that they're dictatorial. But first, since you mentioned Hillary, I don't know if you saw her big national speech last week. She attacked myself, you and others. She attacked Donald Trump like it was bad that he was associated with somebody like you who's changing the world and loved all over the place. Even the left is having to admit you've got good points. And so let's play this clip of Hillary acting like Trump's bad because he's modeling himself after a winner like you. Here it is.
Nigel Farage, who stoked anti-immigrant sentiments to win the referendum to have Britain leave the European Union, campaigned with Donald Trump in Mississippi.
And then Paul Watson in the piece he did on this went on to say, hey, Hillary and Nigel Farage won. Don't forget that part. I think this really illustrates her disconnect, sir.
Well, I just want to, can I please use this opportunity to thank Hillary Clinton from the bottom of my heart for doing what she's done. She's raised my profile massively in this presidential election. She's made me a political football between the Trumpites and the Clintonites, and she's given me an even bigger platform in the United States of America to say to people, we've just won our democracy back. Why don't you do the same thing? So, Hillary, thank you, thank you, thank you.
So here's the paradox. They've got the money, they've got the power, they've stolen control, they got the Swiss bank accounts like the EU bureaucrats that don't pay taxes. You've exposed all that, but people are waking up. They're unelected, they're dictatorial. That's an uphill battle for them. The problem is they're already on top of the hill. How do you see this playing? I mean, in fact, I agree with you. They don't know how to counter. They're panicked right now. I've never seen the media so deceptive. They seem to be doubling down.
Yeah, what we've got to do is to focus on what we can do. And what we can do is to go out and reach the millions, tens of millions of people across the Western world who frankly feel completely disconnected and disenchanted with politics. You know, we've been through these years where, frankly, whichever party you vote for doesn't make very much difference. And where people say, do you know what? I'm not going to bother. It makes no difference. And what we have to do is we have to inspire those people. We have to say to those people, come on, get up off your backside, get down to that polling station, vote. Because it's only by us getting together and doing what we think that we can change things. And that's the lesson, Alex, from Brexit. Nearly 2.5 million people who don't vote or have never voted in their lives went out on June the 23rd and turned it into our independence.
Total history. And of course, they're trying to ignore the vote. It's a battle, but they're going to lose in the end. This is amazing.
They can't. They can't.
In the minute we have left.
They can't ignore the vote. So I would say to people, if you want change in America, then, yeah, listen to these shows. Talk to your friends and neighbors. But actually, you've got to get your walking boots.
Knock on doors.
You've got to get out and meet people, inspire people. And if you do that, we'll strike a blow against the globalists from which they will never, ever recover.
Absolutely. In the minute we have left, sir, I just want to say that obviously you've not really retired. You're here battling the New World Order globally now. You've actually gone to the next level. And I appreciate your time, your energy, and the risk you've taken for yourself and your family. Of course, UKIP.org, the former party you headed up. And of course, people can also follow you on Twitter. We'll put that on screen for TV viewers as well. But this is a great historic time. It is a referendum against the New World Order. And I think Donald Trump's going to win if all of our listeners and others do what you say and take action. So thank you for spending your time trying to help America be a free country as well, Mr. Farage.
No, not one little bit. And I'll be back between now and November the 8th.
Thank you so much, sir. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
I mean, InfoWars is making history. And that big old amplifier, DrudgeReport.com, is watching our six. And we're watching Drudge's six and everybody else's. But I tell you, they tried to kill him over and over again. And I'm not going to get into it. But they've taken the bolts off his tires. The police said that somebody tried to kill him. They messed with his brake lines. His airplane crashed. And that guy basically just marches around all over Europe, you name it, with no bodyguards, basically. He's the real deal. I have young children, and I've never had bodyguards, and I've gotten to the point with stuff going on behind the scenes that I do, and I've hired former highly decorated Army people that are part of security details worldwide, but that's the type of stuff we have to deal with. Our Blitzer Kimmel story is also on Drudge. It's getting crazier. And just to look at the anatomy of propaganda, we'll cover that when we come back. But history's happening. Big things are happening. The fight against tyranny is taking place. And people are deciding what side they're on. You can't read the Soros emails. Even liberal publications are now coming out and saying, okay, Soros is really bad. Okay, he wants to overthrow countries. He wants to create racial division. He wants to destabilize things. It's all there. I mean, a moron would not be able to tell this. A really big moron, an average moron would be able to. I mean, this is crazy. And it doesn't mean the Republicans are going to save us either, but Trump is an insurrection taking over the Republican Party with the populism. And that's why they're throwing everything they've got against him. But Nigel Farage, ladies and gentlemen, making history 25 years ago, starting out, having a huge victory. Imagine where InfoWorlds will be in 4 years. It'll be our 25th anniversary.
We're on the march.
It's all about dehumanizing us.
Treating us like cattle, for food.
And that's what socialists and statists do everywhere, whether it's the Soviet Union or Venezuela or Cuba or North Korea. Every communist system becomes a total collapse nightmare, except for China, because of the classic, hardworking, intelligent nature of the Chinese people, who are the ultimate free market folks. If you go to the cliches, they're true. They have a bifurcated system with communists on top ruling over a bunch of slaves, basically, and free market allowed in certain areas to basically take over the world. The ultimate merger of crony capitalism with communism. Lord Christopher Monckton is joining us till about 5 after the next hour. The Nigel Farage, kind of a Anglophile type transmission today, because so much of the resistance against the New World Order is coming out of the British Isles. Lord Monckton is the former top advisor. He doesn't brag about that, but if you look it up, to Margaret Thatcher. Also been a major newspaper editor, a scientist, a major inventor, and of course, someone who is the leading person publishing scientific papers, some of the most read in the world, or the most read in the world, on the fact that anthropogenic global warming is a fraud. The problem is, and it's now been in even the Associated Press, 14 attorney generals and governors have been meeting in secret, looking to arrest prominent man-made climate change deniers, and they're actually on the news now pushing this. Now, I wanted to get him on last week, but he was too busy to talk about this meme saying that we don't want Hillary Clinton because she's a woman. I mean, I would elect a libertarian, conservative, nationalist, patriot, free market woman in a heartbeat. In fact, I'd love to have a woman president. I'd like it. I don't want a kingpin whose emails just came out that she's actually was paying access for others to get to the Chinese president. This has now reached espionage level. That's confirmed. George Soros has come out in the new emails that have been hacked, and he admits they're real emails saying the UN will run the U.S. police. And the UN will run the internet. These are from 3 years ago. And they'll censor critics of his foundations and not allow us to have voices. So they want to arrest us. They want to shut down the web. Hillary puts out fundraisers 2 weeks ago, emails saying Breitbart doesn't have a right to exist and the alt-right needs to be shut down. And then she comes out and names us by name. Yeah, Alex Jones, Breitbart, Drudge Report. They're coming after us. They're in the news almost every day saying arrest Monckton. These people, we go down to the Democrat crowds down here nicely to interview them, and they start saying they want to kill me. So, Lord Monckton, you've always called them Nazi-like, and people overuse that, but in this case, it's really true. I don't think people realize what's happening. Like, are they doing this because they're panicking? Are they doing this because they believe this is their time to take over? What is the arrogance? Is it a put-on? Is it real? You're a real psychological expert on this. I want to spend some time on powerful women in history, and one of the most, Margaret Thatcher, an incredibly great lady, who stood for Bilderberg, who stopped the euro early on, but after she got out, they pushed it through. I mean, you know, a true nationalist, a true smart, amazing, eloquent woman versus this brand of Samantha Powers and man-hating, nation-hating, wealth-hating, war-loving. I mean, it's bizarre. So I want to talk about that and also some of the latest developments. Scienceofpublicpolicy.org. Thank you so much, sir.
Well, it's a pleasure to be with you, and let's start with women at the top in politics. What is interesting is that in the United Kingdom, it was not just a member of the Conservative Party who became Britain's first Prime Minister, but actually a real Conservative, because most of the Conservative Party members in Parliament are not really Conservatives at all. But Margaret Thatcher was a Conservative, and she became Britain's first woman Prime Minister. So the idea that somehow people are opposed to Hillary Clinton just because she is a woman, I think are very far from the truth. I think they're opposed to Hillary Clinton, and rightly, because she's a crook. And in law, it doesn't matter whether you're a male or a female. If you're a crook, you're a crook. And the hacked emails that are gradually coming out show that she is and was and will probably continue in office to be a crook if the people are unwise enough to elect her. And so, no, there is no prejudice against women on our side of the debate. Far from it, as you have just so very eloquently said, you'll elect a woman provided that she is libertarian and is in favor of peace, low taxes, and none of the hideous totalitarian experiments that you showed in that clip before this segment began. The idea that in Britain now we're using babies as fuel in hospitals. Now, this, of course, is the ultimate ghastliness that even Dr. Mengele didn't think up in Nazi Germany. And what is astonishing is the lack of self-criticality on the part of the communist or fascist left, because, of course, the communists and the fascists are really two sides of the same hard left coin. In fact, if one goes back to China that you mentioned earlier, the early Chinese imperial philosophers said, right, there are the big divide in politics, and it still is the big divide today, thousands of years later, is between the totalitarians, they call them the legalists, and the Confucians, we call those the libertarians. So the totalitarians versus the libertarians.
And now the totalitarians have learned to claim they're the real liberals, but they're not.
No, of course they're not. I mean, the word liberal doesn't apply to the likes of Hillary Clinton. It doesn't apply to the so-called Democrats. Indeed, the word Democrat doesn't apply to the Democrats either. They're not Democrats. They don't believe in elections. They're merely a stepping stone on the way to total totalitarian control. You just have to look at the number of treaties that Mr. Obama has busily been trying to
put
in place.
Unelected. Well,
Euro is a good example. We, thank goodness, stayed out of that. I worked very, very hard to make sure that we did.
Yeah, I should have added you're a major leader of that as well. And, of course, it's not about credit, but people need to know why you're so derided and attacked. I mean, you were like just as important as, say, our George Washington in our beginning in this fight against the New World Order. I mean, it's epic to be able to talk to you
get you everywhere. But the truth is that these battles do have to be fought. And they have to be fought very hard because the international totalitarian left are hoping that they can take over. Why, for instance, are these 14 attorney generals conspiring, for it is a conspiracy, to try to move against that provision in your constitution which guarantees free speech? By saying that those of us who are doing academic research, and quite good academic research at that, say I, suggesting that they've over-egged the pudding on global warming, should be locked up, should be imprisoned for daring to have a point of view other than that of the totalitarian state. Now, this takes us right back to Hitler, and there's no point in not saying so. Of course, they will immediately say, oh, yes, whenever the right get fed up, they say that the socialists are... that Hitler was a socialist. Well, yes, he was.
It was the National Socialist
Workers' Party of Germany. Of course he was left-wing.
That's the name of it. And then the leftist lied and said he was right-wing. But let's expand on this briefly, because I want to get back to Margaret Thatcher. I've never had you on to talk about her. And sometime when you've got a full hour, I know we had some mix-ups today, I'd like to just spend a whole hour on her. She's so interesting when this election's over. What would Margaret Thatcher think today? I mean, you're somebody I know from reading newspaper articles that would advise her sometimes hours a day. She really, really, you were one of her main confidants. She really trusted you. She was a really smart lady. And obviously, she was smart to trust you. You're a really smart guy, obviously. What type of person was Margaret Thatcher? Why was she willing to buck the entire globalist system? And why don't we see more leaders like her? Why don't we see more men like her?
I think the reason is that in politics, it's much government. By its nature, tends to be on the totalitarian rather than on the libertarian side. Government is about control. sometimes for good ends, usually for bad and selfish ends. But it is about control. And therefore, there is a tendency in every governing system to move towards totalitarianism. And one of the exciting things about the constitutional developments that began in the era of Magna Carta and carried on steadily, and of course the American Revolution is part of that tradition of transferring power back from the totalitarian center and into the hands of the people. You know, the American Revolution was fundamentally a libertarian exercise, as was Magna Carta, and as was the election of Margaret Thatcher and her political triumph. These movements towards libertarianism were and are and continue to be valuable. But of course, the totalitarians don't like this. They don't like democracy. They don't like the idea that the people can have their say. They're furious that the people, by a substantial majority of more than a million votes, voted down the European Union and voted for Brexit. Why did we do this? Because we wanted once again to be free. I was talking to a cab driver on the way to a radio interview shortly before the vote, and he said, I'm going to vote to stay in. And I said, may I suggest why you shouldn't? And he said, yes. And I told him how an EU law is made, which is exactly how the left want to make laws everywhere. No democratic input whatsoever. The whole thing done by commissars behind closed doors. And at the end of this brief account by me of how a law is actually made in the European Union, he said, right, I'm voting the other way. I'm voting to get out. And I'm going to tell all my friends they've got to do the same to save our country from this totalitarian takeover. So there is now a real battle going on, a battle which you've been fighting with more than usual prescience and still more than usual vigor for many decades, which is between those who wish to shut down all opposition, and this time not just on a national but on a global level. And that's the significance of Obama and his treaty making. That's the significance of Obama and China ganging up together. Come on, we're all communists together. Let's lock the West into this climate nonsense by ratifying the climate treaty. Now, of course, Obama can't actually ratify the climate treaty because your Senate has to approve it.
Sure, Lord Monckton, I want to get to that in a moment, but since you, I was about to interrupt when you led into this. I see articles every day in the Economist, the Financial Times of London, the New York Times, in fact, the Washington Post. I've got a stack of them here. We're not here hyping the fact that this is an epic battle. Literally, scienceandpublicpolicy.org, Mark Moreno and Climate Depot, DrudgeReport.com, InfoWars, WorldNet Daily, Daily Caller, Breitbart are now the new media. We get more traffic than the mainstream media. They know that. They're scared. We are the legitimate media. We're not perfect, but we really want to tell the truth. We're nationalist. We're not into scams. We don't want to join the authoritarians. I know you could have joined them. I could have joined them. They admit that we are now defeating them at this point. They are in full crisis mode and say we must get Hillary elected. Brexit and UKIP and Nigel Farage and Lord Monckton is spreading everywhere. If the next domino falls, this is the Washington Post, we're over. The G20, as you know, is set to meet, and their new focus is nationalism from Spain to the UK to the United States to Australia, rising. They are in panic mode. So I want listeners to understand, we're not just sitting here telling you all this and saying we've got a fighting chance, but the enemy's going to strike back. This is epic. This, and just as you were finally able to reach that cab driver in a few minutes, wake him up with the outrageousness of the authoritarianism of the EU, what is that blow that will finally take them down? Because I know they're winning at some level because they're still in control and they have the money, but they're losing the intellectual battle. What I'm getting at is, how are they going to strike back? What do we do, Lord Monckton? Because we are now standing in huge history. Our listeners are just as important as we are in history. This information war is so important, what you just illustrated.
Now, we have a mechanism which is very useful in the United Kingdom. I've used it against the BBC. I've used it against government departments. It's called judicial review, administrative action. It's not particularly expensive, provided you know how to work the system. And it allows, if a public authority oversteps the mark, and that's what totalitarians do, they'll always go beyond what the law allows. Here is Obama saying, I'm going to ratify the climate treaty personally. Now, in Britain, if a prime minister said, I'm going to ratify a treaty, and the prime minister didn't have the power to ratify a treaty, I would be able to go straight to the court. It would take precedence over all other business of the administrative court, which is a division of the High Court in London, and say, no, she can't do that. And it would be stopped. Now, you do have a similar system in the United States, but the libertarians are not always as smart as they should be about using the existing mechanisms that are available to you to stop, for instance, outrageous oversteppings of the mark by the EPA or by Obama saying he's going to ratify a treaty he has
no power. Sure, so what do we do then? How do we strike back?
So what you do is you choose your issue carefully. Let us suppose that Obama does eventually try to purport to ratify personally a treaty which your constitution plainly states can only be ratified by a two-thirds majority of the Senate. Then all it takes is one person to go to the federal district court on judicial review and say the president has exceeded his authority and I want this looked at and then stopped. And that will bring the whole nonsense
All right, let me
down.
Expand on that. That was done by the Texas Attorney General. He was then set up and indicted, but it's a fake case. He's doing okay. Literally at a dinner party, he just talked about a company he was in years before and said, I think it's a good investment. Oh, my gosh, he's so evil. The Justice Department comes after him. I'm going to skip this break, folks. It's too important. We're going to lose all the free speech if we don't do this. This battle's total. And then the Supreme Court and others ruled, okay, Obama is not allowed to just ignore law and let illegals in and not even test them for diseases. Stop. Yeah. And Obama said, I'm not stopping. What do you do at that point when he is a naked Tyrannosaurus?
Well, he is then in contempt of court, and you go back to the court for an order requiring him to stop. And once you...
That's right. Where is the Supreme Court on an injunction or Congress? With that court order could be prosecuting Obama impeachment.
If you go to the court and you say you've made an order, Obama has decided to flout it. If that's what's happened here, and I haven't looked at this.
Well, the word is Scalia was going to rule against him.
If that's what's happened, then he is in contempt of court. And if you go back to the court and you say you gave this order, he is ignoring it. Then they can issue an order for his arrest and imprisonment until he agrees to comply with the order of the court. And that's what you should do. It's not expensive. It is your right. And the court, if it has made a plain judgment and he is plainly flouting it, has no choice, even if it's stacked with all his cronies, it has no choice but to order his arrest. And that's what you've got to start to do. I mean, I did this a few years ago when the British government was trying to pass a thing called the Maastricht Treaty, which was the latest stage then of locking us into this EU monstrosity. And I discovered that against Parliament's instructions, they'd been spending taxpayers' money on various aspects of the Maastricht Treaty, even though we hadn't at that time ratified it. And this was contrary to the law. I took them to the Court of Session in Edinburgh, which is the equivalent of the Administrative Court in London, and the Attorney General for Scotland, the Lord Advocate, as he's called, had to come personally to try to defend himself in court. And in the end, he won on a technicality because the EU budget, line 14,973 for the previous year, had overruled the British Parliament's decision, and the British Parliament had never read this document, so it didn't even know. And on that technicality, we lost the case. But then they came after me for their expenses. And I said, no. And they said, you've got to pay them because you came second. And I said, no, I won't. Instead, I want to know the date of the Lord's Advocate's proposed resignation from office. And they said, what do you mean? I said, those are my instructions. I told my solicitors, you tell them that. So they told the Lord Advocate's office that I wanted to know when he was going to
resign. And the point is, you made him admit that Al Gore's movie was a fraud, so they stopped showing it in UK schools. You've done this scores of times. Let me ask you this then. And by the way, I'll put it on screen if you didn't know, because it didn't get a lot of attention. The Supreme Court 3 months ago ruled him just ignoring law and saying the border's wide open and ordering them to ship illegals in to God knows where is illegal. He has continued. I can put the CNN on screen word box, and so well, you can
then,
see that.
Then, as I say, let me just finish this story, because when I told them that he'd have to resign, they backed off and said, okay, we won't ask for our costs. They knew he was acting against the law by demanding costs from me, and he couldn't get away with it, or he would have gone to prison. And it's the same with Mr. Obama. If the immigration decision of the Supreme Court is sufficiently clear, and if it is sufficiently clear that he is in breach of an order of the Supreme Court,
it says he's breaking the law,
then all you have to do, if he continues to break the law, is to go back to the Supreme Court and say he's still doing it and ask for them to order his arrest and to be brought to
court. Sure, and I mean, to their credit, even though Scalia was dead,
yes,
the split court still said Obama was wrong. So,
that's
I mean,
right.
It's very clear.
So what you must now do is stop simply bloviating and start acting. You have to do what I did, take them to court. And it's really simple. The mechanism in this case is that if the Supreme Court has issued an order of which he is in breach, then all any citizen has to do is to go before that court, say, here is the evidence that he is in breach, and I want it stopped. And they are then obliged to order his arrest. They are obliged to order him to attend the court, obliged to give him his chance to have his say and say why he thought it was appropriate to ignore an order of the Supreme Court. And if they are not satisfied with his explanation, and if he continues to refuse to back off, they can and should, and if you want my guess, will, send him to jail. That's how you fight back against these people. Use their own mechanisms against them.
I agree. I guess I could go file it. I don't want to just bloviate here, but who should go file this? It should be a governor?
Any citizen. Any citizen has the same right as any other citizen. When there is a breach of a court order as serious as this, citizen has. Right.
Okay, Lord Moncton, we're going to go to break in a moment, so just hold for just one moment. But first, I want to just add to listeners and viewers, we're in an information war. It's very important to support the broadcast, spread the word. Internet censorship is kicking in. Don't take this show or scienceandpublicpolicy.org for granted. Spread those papers, those articles. We're in an info war. Show people the facts. Take advantage of our Hillary for Prison t-shirts at cost, $9.95, shipping included. That's at cost with shipping, $9.95. BioTrue Selenium, amazing cofactor in the body. You must have it for electrochemical activity. 20% off based on mustard seed, the best formula out there. Vitamin Mineral Fusion, incredible multivitamin with all the amino acids and cofactors. Great tasting fruit punch, absolutely organic and natural. 20% off, InfoWarsLife.com or call toll free 888-253-3139. But whatever you do, get that Hillary for President shirt because it's shaking the media up. Okay, getting back to you, Lord Moncton. What else is on the table here? What other big events are happening? What else are we looking at that you're tracking?
Right, here is a very interesting one. On the 8th and 9th of September in London, at the instigation of Professor Niklas Murner, the world's greatest expert on sea level, who, like all of us, believes that the global warming thing has been vastly exaggerated, there is the London Climate Change Conference, starting at 9 o'clock in the morning on the 8th and 9th of September in Conway Hall, which is in London. Conway Hall, you can find it on the web very easily. Just turn up on the day and come into that conference. We have professors from all over the world, leading doctors and professors of science, and we will be looking at various scientific aspects of this climate change question. I will be chairing the open session of the conference. I'll be concluding the final session on the 9th, which is the second day of the conference, by making a major announcement about errors that have been identified in the computer models that have produced these wildly exaggerated predictions of global warming. These errors are serious, and once the errors are exposed, that's the end of the scare. So make sure you make your way to that climate change conference in London at the Conway Hall, and that is on the 8th and the 9th of September, starting at 9 a.m. Very important you should do that.
Absolutely. Let me ask you this question. It was hackers that brought out the high the decline stuff, the fact that it was all a big scam. It's multinationals, it's Americans, it's Brits, it's Russians, you name it. But aren't hackers really the secret weapon in all this? Because what do we have to fear? We're not doing anything wrong. But these criminals like Hillary, they've got to be really freaked out.
They are running scared now, and they're running particularly scared on this climate question because the scientific argument just continues to collapse as temperatures fail to rise at anything like the previously predicted rates. And
Lord Moncton, I've got to go to break. Do five more minutes with us, and Nigel Farage is coming on. We're back in 70 seconds if you can, Lord Moncton. I know it's nighttime over there. I'm going to come back, have you finish up, and then go to Nigel Farage, the former leader of UKIP. Stay with us. Yeah, people always ask me, who are you working for? Who's behind you? I've had intelligence agency people, even from foreign governments, that wanted to come visit us. And I was polite and met with them years ago. I've had our own government come and visit with me, and I've met with them. And I've had you know, like police chiefs and stuff come in and they're just like, you're not the only guy doing this, are you? You know, you got to have something else that's behind this. And no, it's called resistance. It's called history. It's called will. It's called an incredible audience that aren't just spectators, but are in the arena. The Patriots. You go to a Trump rally of every race, color, creed, go-getters, not a piece of trash on the ground. Everybody polite, nice, smart, informed. You go look at a Hillary event, it looks like the living dead and just crazy people protesting and attacking, just all fighting with each other. It just shows what we're up against is easily defeated if we just decide to take action against it. There are a lot of folks smarter than I am. And I built the InfoWar in 21 years, and it's now changing the world because of you. Now, Julian Assange, very powerful interview he did with the New York Times, where he just drops bombshell after bombshell. First, he talks about demographics in Russia. Then he gets into Hillary. He wants to put the press's neck in a noose. And that's the point I'm at. I mean, everybody knows this. I mean, the creator of Dilbert endorsed Hillary because he was getting death threats. We have now entered this authoritarian crucible, and I'm not backing down. Here is part of Julian Assange's most powerful interview yet.
What we are drawing attention to is the amazing transformation of Hillary Clinton and the Democratic Party into being the National Security Party and the National Security Candidate by whipping up a neo-McCarthyist hysteria about Russia. Any serious analyst understands that China and the United States are the only real games in town. China has 10 times the population of Russia, 7 times the GDP. Russia has the GDP of Italy. It's interesting in that it wants to be, you know, that it makes provocative statements and so on. It's interesting. And of course, within its own neck of the woods, countries in between Russia and China, Caucasus and so on. Of course, Russia is very significant to them. But on the world stage, Russia is a bit player. That attempted reframing by Hillary Clinton to declare media organizations that are publishing material that shows illicit behavior in the DNC to fix the election for her as somehow us being Russian agents. Similar criticism has emerged from people connected to her campaign to The Intercept, where Glenn Greenwald works. Her campaign has effectively called, and maybe even directly called, Donald Trump, the opposition leader in this case, a Russian agent. Jill Stein, the Greens Party candidate, effectively the fourth candidate in terms of numbers, being called a Russian agent. This is a neo-McCarthyist hysteria. What kind of press environment is this going to lead to post-election? The American press, in the American liberal press, in falling over themselves to defend Hillary Clinton, are erecting a demon that is going to put nooses around everyone's necks as soon as she wins the election, which he is almost certainly going to do.
You know, people would ask me if I liked Assange going back 8-9 years ago, and I said, yeah, I see no fault in him. And they go, oh, he's a, you know, left-wing, blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, we'll see when Democrats get in what he does. And then if he goes after them when they're bad, he knows he's a hero. He is. He's a hero. And I've never, that is pure veritas what you heard. The press climate. They are coming after the press like never before. This is the stuff that dictatorships and authoritarian regimes are made of. We're in danger.
But I'm here to remind you of who we are. We're the sons and daughters of abolitionists. Men and women who gave their lives to fight against slavery. But make no mistake about it, slavery has returned. And she is more vicious than ever before. Because this time she is colorblind. 31%. 31% of white Americans are welfare recipients. 33% of black Americans have fallen for the same rules, and 28% of the Latino community has believed the lie that the government can take care of you from the cradle to the grave. All the while losing their humanity. So when Trump talks about the lies that the Democrat Party has told and the failed policies, both in economics, education, and crime, your heart should be stirred with passion and strength to do something about it.
That is R.W. Bray. And out of all the clips from the Austin event that we were obviously there covering, that clip, I thought last week, was the most powerful. And his words are true. They're strong. But it isn't even the eloquence. It's the force behind it. The way you delivered it was so heartfelt. Talking to folks that were there and my reporters, they said that it really, the energy in the room was so strong during that. And this declaration, basically like Moses saying, we're going to come out of this thing. And then I started just thinking back about being in a Republican family growing up, and I never heard anything racist. In fact, I heard about bad things that people done, how we had to build a free market economy to bring everybody up. And then I would run into Democrats as I grew up, and they would be so racist. And I was like, but the TV says it's the Democrats that are the anti-racist. And it's just, and it wasn't until I was like even 30. I'd been on the air years before I even started even figuring it out, because the deception is so total. I can't blame some of the Democrats and people that still buy into this, because I'm a pretty smart guy, and I was fooled. So I now once you're awake, you're like, what's wrong with these idiots? But it's just people don't know history. Mm-hmm. And those that don't know history, to repeat it, R.W. Bray. I'm going to go over his amazing military career and all the things he's done. And he's the engagement director of the Republican Party of Texas. I'm not going to go over it all. RWBray.com, TexasGOP.org. And let's be clear. I always want to be clear. I'm not lionizing the Republican Party. It's done a lot of horrible stuff, and it's certainly been involved. But that's different people. But the point is, it's not the party that they've been saying it is. Now, I've invited you here, and I'm ranting. You drove here from Houston. I want to get into this with you, and I want to give you the floor. The reason I'm so honored you just said you'd come in to see us instead of just on the phone is because I want to, you know, give folks not just 5 minutes of your speech, but people to really let you take over if you want and kind of give us a sermon on your life, your development, what took you to this point. Because I think all of us are going through this process, but how do we accelerate that in others that haven't? Thank you so much, sir.
No, thank you for having me.
Really appreciate you coming in. So take over.
First, let me tell you that my wife adores you. She's a new fan ever since you all reached out. She had never really saw it. She started reaching out, looking more at your clips, and she thinks that you're phenomenal.
Well, I'm humbled. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't know. I think the story kind of is very simple. The speech actually was from my heart. I think that's the only way to be able to express from a black lens the importance of us adopting Republicanism. And for me, I'm actually a... I'm from Louisiana originally. Consider myself a person who I evacuated from Katrina. I was in the Guard at the time, so I after evacuating, I had to run back. Actually, I was called up to serve. I was given the order to find 10 families in Houston who had evacuated with me and bring them back, even though I was in Baton Rouge. So I actually had to drive to Houston, find 10 families, bring them back to Baton Rouge, and then take the mothers and the husbands who were actually Guard members to serve. So I did a month in search and rescue and 3 months of ICU, and that's where my conversion starts. Unfortunately, I didn't have the benefit of being raised in a Republican family. I was raised a Democrat.
See, I didn't know your story, but I think for all of us, it's humanizing it. How you get to the point of this powerful speech that goes worldwide and wakes up so many people. I just knew it would be very interesting.
Yes, it's a story in and of itself, but I'll give you a fast version of it. I was taking a Black Hawk trip, and as I was taking the Black Hawk trip, we were actually looking for movement. That was our goal. We had to look for any life. It was devastating, and just devastation upon devastation. And I remember looking at the east side of New Orleans, and it was all gray, Alex. Everything was gray. So we gave up looking for life, and so we circled back around.
By gray, you mean gray water?
Just gray water, gray houses, you know.
Yeah, no heat in the flare.
Nothing. Nothing was going on. And so we got to the Riverwalk, and I saw the pilot starting to cry. And I looked down, and it's nothing but men and women who look just like me. And that's when I knew we had believed a lie. But the government cannot take care of you. It was droves of African-Americans with their hands up in America looking for something to be dropped down.
I don't know the story, but let me guess. What color was the pilot?
White.
And my whole point is that we're just all human beings.
That's right.
And the way they play on this, and then even when the military goes out, you know, Obama said a few weeks ago about Louisiana again, he said, be sure don't be racist teams that are going in there. I have family that was there as well, who was active duty Army, but they actually brought them in on that with the helicopters, and they were there working 18 hours a day.
Oh, yeah.
I had family get really hurt there. And I tell you, it really pisses them off when they're not, when they care about everybody,
yes,
and they're being told they're racist, even as they're saving people. So, I mean, what I get from that is, don't let me put words in your mouth. Are you saying that was another big moment for you to see that?
Yes, that was a shocking moment for me. And the amazing thing is that we circled back around to the east side later on that day because you had to do footwork as well as air. So we went through the homes, you know, making the marks on the walls and whatnot. And in the rubbish of a house, I found a book called Up From Slavery by Booker T. Washington. And so I took that book, washed it off, and I had a small little tent where our area was. And at night, I would read that book, and it changed my life. Booker T. Washington was a entrepreneur. He was an education advocate. He started his own university. It would be no Tuskegee Airmen if it wasn't for this guy. It would be no Tuskegee University if it wasn't for this guy. But I saw his story literally from, he went from dirt floors to marble. And he gave one of the most powerful speeches, the Atlanta Compromise, I had ever heard in my life.
And by the way, I mean, because I know this history, for those that don't, and I'm not defending segregation, it was horrible, but we replaced one evil with another. It was his model and system that made black communities in many areas wealthier in the white areas, which created the institutional racism even more, and they started pushing massive class warfare between poor whites and poor blacks, and that's when LBJ and all them came in with, we're going to get the men out of the house, we're going to break these communities down, because blacks just said, okay, you're going to suppress us, we're going to create our own community.
That's right.
And so they got rid of it. See, I didn't even know this, you knew all this, because almost no one knows this, I'm trying to explain to people. Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
So if Americans, period, would do what Booker T. Washington did, we'll explain it to people then.
Yeah, so Booker T. Washington, like I said, advocate for education. He could not get what I would call racist whites to invest at all into his.
But did you do it yourself?
So he did it himself, and he went out. He got investors, Republican investors, which is exactly what I'm advocating now. I don't like for us to go around making excuses, but they.
You mean the racist, the Republican Party that founded the KKK. Oh, it's the Democrats. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot about that.
Those are the Democrats. And it's amazing. I love the fact that you're knowledgeable of this history. And I tried to give a brief history at the Trump rally. And
my dad's side were Republicans and went through a lot of crap over it. Wow. In fact, I never told the stories on air because it's over the top. But can you imagine East Texas being Republicans in the 40s and 50s and 60s? It was not a very...
I can only imagine.
Yeah.
I can only imagine.
But I'm a racist as well.
Anyways. Yeah, which is why you're having me on the show.
Exactly. No, but I mean, it just shows how those that don't know history don't repeat it. The public, period, doesn't know history.
No.
Please continue with your story.
And that was my conversion. Between that experience, Katrina, obviously, and the book, seeing a black man who had it was unapologetic for being a Republican, changed my entire life and my whole view of how I needed to advance my life. It was then I realized that I needed to start getting active, and ushers in why I'm now an advocate for the Republican Party of Texas. I'm a proud advocate. I would not have I not made changes then and changed my idea of what success was, what knowledge was, what education was, and how to run my political life, I would have never had the opportunity to be able to give a speech at a Trump rally to ignite fire in millions of people. But more importantly, I'm on the show that touches millions because of you. And we have a common heart. You
know? Well, that's what Trump does, is whether it's myself or you, he gives a voice to other people that have important information. And then he's helping magnify a whole new group of people.
That's right.
To truly create real diversity of ideas and thought.
That's right.
And really not have teleprompters, but come together.
That's
and just
right.
get real. Because our country's in trouble.
Oh, yeah. And you have the energy of John Brown. I love it because I'm not sure if your listeners know who John Brown is, but John Brown was good friends with Frederick Douglass. He was a powerful abolitionist, powerful advocate, who wanted to basically end slavery at all costs to the point he got militia to do it. He was going to overtake the entire government.
Killed,
yeah. But he wound up, white racists wound up hanging this guy for even trying to do this. But I think, I'll play to God, they never hang you, but I think the fire that you have is reminiscent of those days, and I think that's what's coming. I think there's going to be a second reconstruction, and I think it's going to happen through people who get galvanized and ignite a fire underneath their bellies to start doing something.
Yeah, the Democrats are playing total race card. You want to write back to their KKK roots. I mean, I'm not just demonizing them. They deserve it. I mean, Julian Assange is a real liberal. He says Hillary Clinton is a demon. R.W. Bray from Louisiana. I'm from right here in Texas. I'm family in East Texas, which is basically Louisiana. And we were talking earlier about wild stuff that we even told people they wouldn't believe it unless you've lived in the South, about the Democratic Party. And just if all the stupid liberals knew what we knew. This is only a 6-minute segment, long segment coming up. We'll give out the number and take calls. Let's get into those brush fires you've been setting with the Trump campaign. And preach if you want. Take over.
Yes, we've been tearing them up, Alex. We spent a lot of time in Texas dispelling the myths and lifting the veil. One of the things that we've done is, Republican parties kind of tried to take an approach where they would do outreach. Well, we changed that. We changed the language of outreach to engagement, and we figured the Democrat Party is going to integrate themselves into our communities, then the Republican Party is going to integrate themselves back into the Black community. And that's exactly what we did. And so we teamed up and collaborated with different organizations, from Black Chamber of Commerce's who were pushing entrepreneur programs to IPEAT, which is a faith-based program. It's all about taking underprivileged men and women in the 3-4 and the 5th wards of Houston, which is predominantly Black, and lifting them up, giving them jobs, economically independent, hooking them up with their civic presidents to become civically involved, and teaching them the importance of integrity and standing up as men so they don't return back to the prisons. So we're actually in the communities that we once were trying to preach from afar. We're out in the streets preaching, and I think it's changing the rhetoric and the language of what people think of Republicanism. So we actively are rebranding Republicanism.
Is it right to say that the Black community, after 8 years of neglect from Obama, unemployment rate almost doubling for Black Americans, that they're ready for the wake-up call? Because that's what we see in the streets. But then I see the news, spinning it, that African Americans don't like Trump, but the numbers even show that record numbers do.
You're absolutely right. I cannot tell you how many phone calls I've received since that speech. People have found my number somehow, and they are emailing, they are texting, they are calling me on Facebook, sending messages, and most of these individuals are Blacks, and these are African Americans who are sick of the system. You have so many gay is not the new Black, number one, and that's something that I get across a lot. They'll say, hey, we don't have anything against the lesbian community or the gay community, but we don't think it's the same plight. So what do we need to do? Well, you're in the party that is not going to preach that. BLM just received over 100, I think it was 100 million from Ford. And so they're going to try and push 100 million to press Black Lives Matter. And one of the things on there, initiatives that have nothing to do with Black Lives. Black Lives has nothing to do with...
It's creating victimology with a string so they can make everybody dance. They're puppet strings where you're a victim, we're the people you trust. By the way, we're going to double your unemployment.
At the same time.
I mean, that's all they're doing. They're just creating the identity isn't who you are individually, or going out and doing all these great innovations. And that's what I go back to with what happened with, it's not that the oppression was good, but that which doesn't kill you only makes you stronger. People say, what are you doing endorsing, slavery or segregation? No. My point is, like special forces, people being pressured to get better, it made people innovate, where so many of the famous inventions were created by people with no education that were African because they absolutely had to survive.
That's right.
And then you see, quote, government-free handouts creating devastation.
That's right. And liberals have a way of insidiously doing that. I mean, you think about it. The top Democrat states in America are led by white liberals. There's only, if you take the top 12 states that are typically vote blue, there's only one Black Democrat. So basically, yeah, we want you 94% vote, but you can't lead our party. The DNC, 94% African Americans are voting black, but the DNC is a white liberal. And so that's just like the plantation mindset. They know how to set the crops up to harvest later. And for them, the blacks are the slaves that offer them the votes they need in order to stay in office.
Well, I'll say this, because they're going to screw over the Hispanics as well. They want cheap labor and a new, you know, permanent underclass. But right now, they're going, oh, my God, blacks are waking up.
That's
right. You better switch over to Hispanics. And that's why you've seen such a total abandonment.
That's right. And the sad thing is that African-Americans in those areas don't see the importance and the power of their vote. No one party should have a monopoly over the black vote. People want it. They need to earn it. And the African-Americans have given their vote over to Democrats, and they've lost their power.
Let's talk about Trump. We're going to break in a minute. But what's your, like, in-person meeting him? What's your impression?
He's just like you. Truly. He's the guy who says what he thinks. He gives it to you straight, no chaser. You got to appreciate being a man like that. Doesn't matter. You know, we've gone to this PC world where you just can't say anything that's really on your mind. Well, that's not the way you
see right.
things moving.
Well, they claim that, you know, we want to get rid of this establishment, and Congress has a 9% approval rating, and the media has a 6%. And then here's the whole thing we hate. The whole system that we say we don't want is having conniption fits over Donald Trump. People are insane if they don't. I mean, it's like you said, what do you have to lose? You're getting screwed over. I'm going to make better deals. Guaranteed. It's guaranteed. We'll be right back. R.W. Bray, rwbray.com. Just rwbray.com. I'm Alex Jones, your host. Again, I'm not going to belabor this. If you want to support the broadcast, support local affiliates, become a sponsor of those local stations, spread the word, paint Infowars.com on the side of your barn, put up a billboard, buy the products, great nutraceuticals like selenium that we just came out with. It's from the mustard seed, the best bioavailable form out there. It's using all electrochemical activity in the body to get all the toxins out of the cells. You name it, you die without it. People are massively, massively, I'm going to take some right now, massively not getting enough selenium out there. Do your own research. Look into what selenium does. Cancer rates, you name it. It is truly a game changer. And it fuses with iodine, but nobody's got the proper type of iodine. We have the only true nation iodine from our research that's out there. It's from a deep earth source, not from seaweed. The stuff we have would eat through three layers of steel building like in the movie Alien. I mean, that's how powerful the good halogen is. But then through a special patented Russian technique, I guess we are now Russian agents. I guess that's a Russian connection. The media's got it. It is then injected into organic palm oil and then is no longer stuff that'll eat through steel girders. And I'm just documenting for you how powerful this halogen is. It's in the same family as fluoride, chlorine, all the garbage that just inundates our environment. And you take selenium, you take this, you take enough vitamin C. We don't sell that because there's so many good sources of it out there naturally. They all work in synergy. But if you don't have one of these, you die. And deficiencies in it are just record level. Record level. Your cells don't have this. They start malfunctioning. They start mutating. There's a name for that. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. Or simply call toll-free 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. And we also have Hillary for Prison shirts at cost, because I just want to see 100,000 of these are already out there. It's already sending shockwaves. It's all over the news constantly. It's one of the most searched terms this year on the internet. And we started it. You started it. You bought the shirts. You got them out there. You did the work. I had the idea. But it all goes together like a horse and carriage. And we have the Support the InfoWar. You can click and get it for $19.95 at full price if you want, where we make $10 to fund things, or $9.95 shipping included. $5 for the shirt, $5 to ship it on average. So choose $19.95 if you want to help us, or doesn't matter, you're helping us getting it at $9.95. We're all helping each other. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com is nutraceuticals. 20% off our great vitamin mineral fusion fruit punch. From our research, again, this is the, because I always say that, because there might be something better out there. And if there is, we're gonna go out and private label it. This is the best game-changing multivitamin mineral system for full absorption, or the highest level of absorption for you and your family, just like our methylcobalamin Secret 12 is nutraceutical grade, you know, pharmacy grade vitamin B12. It's the same stuff people inject. Don't inject this. It's for under the tongue. If you want to inject it, it's even more absorbable. Go get it from a doctor. But minus that, and let me tell you, injectable from a doctor is like way up here. Our stuff's down here, but everything else is way down here. I mean, you don't absorb basically any of the synthetic trash that's out there. Put it under your tongue, hold it for a minute, and you're going to get closer to an injection. Not as good, just going to be honest with you, but it is a game changer. I sit around with top scientists, developers, chemists, and I say, what are game changers, missing links? There's a ton of them because most nutraceutical companies will put $10 into marketing, $2 into what's in it, and then sell it for $100. We don't do that. We have 100% markup on average. The average is 7 times the markup. No, I'm going to put quality in the bottle, do 100% markup, fund our operation, have all the big health sites go crazy over what we're doing, dominate the market, and have all these people buying our products that aren't even listeners now. In fact, we're getting a lot of listeners from people getting the products because they're that good. I went out and found the top 3 developers of nutraceuticals in the country, and I did deals with all 3 of them. The group's just one of them. The others are too scared to come on air from big companies, even bigger than Group. I mean, some of these companies are supplying like a third of the stuff at Whole Foods, just so you know. And so that's why our stuff is so good. And plus, it's got to be bulletproof with the government coming after us, how they harass supplement makers. I want it to be great quality for everybody. I want you to come back. I want you to get a good deal. I want to be treated like I treat other people. It's like revolutionary. No, that's what built America, folks. All I'm doing is just like he did, going back and reading history books by people that actually built this country, like Booker T. Washington and others. It goes on and on and on. And the innovation of hybrid crops and modern developments came from people that were oppressed in this country, black Americans. And again, I'm not pushing oppression. The point is, open oppression makes you stronger. You should smash it. But what we're being killed by is all this largesse, how easy everything's gotten, and the not being aware. Now, I want to take phone calls. 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231, R.W. Bray, rwbray.com. He is the Black Engagement Director of the Republican Party of Texas. He's a military veteran and a patriot, and we appreciate him being, he's currently a master sergeant serving as first sergeant guardsman and proud veterans advocate in Houston, Texas. And a lot of other community stuff for children, you name it, the MLK Association, vice chair of Texas. I'm going to stop right there. That's another thing, MLK, a Republican. It goes on and on. But give us your greatest hits. I mean, you know, what's really powerful, what folks need to know, sir, and what Trump needs to do to win, what we need to do to win.
Strategically, I think Trump needs to make sure that he has advocates and surrogates in North Carolina, Wisconsin, PA, Michigan. Reason why is because, number one, that's the Rust Belt. Number two, places like Ohio, we have a significant black population who are waiting for an answer. Their neighborhoods are being torn apart by bitter rivalries, whether that's through gangs or whether that's just the simple fact that people are living in poverty, they are fed up, and they are overreacting and reacting by killing their own. That is a consequence of the Democrat lead. Think about this, Alex. 50 council members in Chicago, 49 of which are Democrat, 1 Republican. And you look across the nation, wherever there's Democrats in lead, in leadership, there is a failing municipality. And that's because there is some ideology.
Because they're satanic.
I would agree.
Sorry.
I would agree. But there are some ideologies that work, and there's some that don't. The thing about Republican ideology is that they are timeless, traditional. They've always worked. They always will, provided we remember. And the fact of the matter of fact is that humans often have a bad habit of losing memory.
I agree. Those that don't know history didn't repeat it. Please continue.
Yeah. Well, one of the ways that we're jabbing at this thing, and I gotta say this. I really love your Hillary shirt. I have a good friend of mine, Carl Maniola, came into the Trump rally with me. We almost got kicked out because they didn't read the thing. But when they finally read it.
No, it's a great conversation starter. Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. They finally read it and they allowed him to come in. But I think that agitating the current status quo, like your shirt, it agitates people. We need to continue to agitate people verbally, though, and that's the problem. There aren't enough black surrogates. If Trump wants to make a dent,
well, exactly. In fact, that shows how sophisticated you are, because I barely even realized it when I did it. I always have the idea, and then I see the thinking behind it later. It's like my brain just knows. I wanted it to cause debates.
That's right.
And cause discussions.
That's right.
And say Hillary for prison. That's our campaign.
Yes.
And then it's really caught on. But please continue.
Well, that's what Frederick Douglass stood for. Frederick Douglass, the very first father of civil rights movement, stood for 3 things. He said, number one, He stood for economic independence. Number two, social and business collaboration. And number
Frederick Douglass on screen. That guy, he'd be a movie star today. I mean, that guy just looks so cool.
Yes. And number three, his last one was agitation. Agitation. One of the last things that he said in his last speech, a young black man at a university asked him, as a young black man, what should I be doing? He says, agitate, agitate, agitate. And what I see in InfoWars, what I see in people like Trump and yourself and others that I've come across the nation is that we are ready. Political agitation has moved the needle.
Yeah, what you're saying is we're not trying to play in the corrupt system. We're changing it. We're not trying to play by their rules and go along with it. We're expanding the entire paradigm.
That's right. And what better place to start than Texas? The RPT is doing powerful things. We're going to areas that no other state is going. We're getting calls that no other state is calling. And when you think about that,
they rewrote Ron Paul's district over and over again. They kept rewriting it for Democrats and black areas thinking, and then he won by even bigger landslides.
That's right.
Because people go meet him. He's just a sweet, loving doctor that had been volunteering 3 days a week for decades.
Yes.
At poor hospitals.
That's right.
And this is a guy who literally would volunteer 2 or 3 days a week at poor hospitals.
That's right.
Because he, for no money.
That's right.
Because he believed in it. And of course, he's racist Ron Paul, though.
Well, most people believe that common sense isn't common these days, but the truth is that it is. People know common sense when they see it. They see earnestness. They see a man with the correct heart. They see a person who has passion, and they will gravitate toward it. If Trump continues to make sure that he goes into these black neighborhoods, regardless of whatever the media is saying, continue to go, because I'm in those black neighborhoods.
He's been doing it.
Yeah, and they like it. They like the fact that finally someone is coming into those neighborhoods and talking, and that's how we're going to win.
Meanwhile, Obama vacations 100 days a year and doesn't even care about Louisiana and gets away with it. I mean, I'm not defending Bush. He had some problems big time. But he some problems with Katrina response. At least he responded. They don't even show up. Hillary doesn't even care. It's like...
Well, I had a show on Lifting the Veil until the liberals got mad. It was in Houston, and they killed this show. But it was called Lifting the Veil off of Booker T. Washington. It was amazing.
Oh, local radio?
Over radio.
Oh, yeah, they kill shows.
Oh, yeah,
we get knocked off all the time. They'll come and say, $300,000, take him off.
Yeah, they're good at it. But one thing that really I touched on was that if Obama really, really cared for African-Americans, or the current administration, period, we had one opportunity to get a Supreme Court judge, and a Latino was appointed. We had another one, and the LGBT was appointed. Even his third choice that he tried to come was not a black person. So a lot of people in the black neighborhoods are starting to see that this guy never was going to make our lives better. And the truth is that you can't depend on the government to make your life better. Only you can do that.
Plus, to use the analogy, I mean, it's being pimped. I already got you. I don't need to.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, you say... Boom.
It's a given. It's about time that we start listening to our ancestors. X talked about not trusting liberals. One of the greatest quotes he ever said was, keep in mind that a Dixiecrat is nothing more than a Democrat in disguise. He talked about the fact that one party we had been invested in has abandoned us, that it was a racist from the beginning and it will always be racist. MLK warned us of not judging men by his color and not his content. You got blacks who won't join the Republican Party simply because there's a lot of white people in it.
And let's explain. It creates a self-fulfilling prophecy where they say the Tea Party's racist, and so then minorities who are majorities in this area don't go. And what the real racism is the media pushing that, but then what's happening on the Trump phenomenon, I want you to speak to this because it's documented, black Americans, Hispanic Americans, others are going, and they're absolutely being appreciated by everybody, and they're like, wow, this is incredible, and people are coming together. It's very cathartic. I've seen people crying.
That's right.
I mean, this is crazy. So again, they create the perception, which makes it the reality.
Oh, yeah. We have modern-day abolitionists right now. People who brave people of different colors going to those neighborhoods saying, come with me to this. Come with me to see Hillary's America. Come with me to watch this. And they're learning. There was a black woman who was at the Trump rally who was brought by two white friends. And she was right up front. I thought that was amazing. So there are modern-day abolitionists. But more importantly, I believe this is the rebirth of a second Reconstruction. W.E. Du Bois even said that he wished that the Reconstruction had finished its mark. It never finished what it was supposed to do. Now it has an opportunity to do that. Republicans need to wake up and know.
Well, they got hijacked by a lot of corruption when Lincoln got killed.
Well, obviously, yeah. You cut off the head of the snake, right?
Yeah. All I know is I don't know how Trump gets blamed for being in the KKK when 20 years ago and 10 years ago, he decried David Duke. And then meanwhile, Hillary's kissing all over Robert Byrd, the KKK wizard. I mean, it's just, you can't make this up. I mean, it's just...
No, and I think another thing is, just to add something to it, the black community has finally woke up to Margaret Sanger and her lies. You know, we have a population that is declining in the black neighborhood. When you consider 120 years ago, black population made up 30, we're at 12 to 13% now. So over a century and a half, we only make up 13%.
Oh, I know. That's the fundamental where I'm told you're racist because you don't want Black Lives Matter and George Soros trying to turn black people into racist so that... In fact, there was a big study out last week. I meant to cover it. I didn't get into it. Major university study. Can you guys pull it up? Diversity programs actually make things less diverse and hurt minority communities. Absolutely.
Yes.
You turn Hispanics and black people into basically KKK versions for minority groups, mm-hmm. hopping up and down. Truly real progressive business owners, I don't care what color they are, don't want trouble.
That's
and
right.
They're just, all of a sudden, they're not racist. They're scared. And people are looking like chips. I mean, the worst thing about spoiled kids, and we've all got them, mm-hmm. you know, nowadays in the society, is that they always think there's a chip on their shoulder and you did something to them. Mm-hmm. And that's part of maturity, is getting past having a chip on your shoulder. And they're just trying to install chips on people's shoulders.
Yes.
Like it's a degree or something.
Yes.
When all it is an anchor around your neck.
And speaking of anchors, the anchor institutions, black anchor institutions like NAACP are now fighting against charter schools and academies. P. Diddy actually just created a charter school in New York. The NAACP is going to be trying to fight to kill it. Oh, nationwide, it is now a mandated.
And good for P. Diddy.
Yeah,
I'm gonna help people that want to get out of this hell.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And if they don't know how to teach our children, then why not get a retired superintendent, retired teachers in the area, and create a charter school and teach those kids in a way that the liberal whites are failing? Why is that bad? The truth is that the Democrat Party wants to corral African Americans and minorities into one area so they can control them.
Absolutely. I want to go to Tony and Carl and Mike and Alex and Dave and others. We've only got 5 minutes in the next segment, and then 5 minutes more before the next hour starts. And who do we have taking over today in the fourth hour? David Knight will always be doing a great job. So much to cover. They're launching massive censorship initiatives that Drudge is covering, drudgeport.com. YouTube's new terms of service just says if you're an extremist, we're going to take your monetization away. That's economic gulags. Okay, that's what Hitler and the ghettos. I mean, this is a major move. It's the Chinese social credit model, and Drudge is covering all that. Paul Watson's article. But let's take a phone call before we go to break. Like I just can't help it. I'm going to skip this network break, even though it costs us like $5,000. I'm doing it because I need to just have more time here. So callers realize that. Let's go ahead and talk to Tony. He says he's an NBC whistleblower. I was calling for whistleblowers a few days ago, and some called in to talk about the atmosphere with this unified press environment, which Assange is just like, this is like totalitarianism. This is the unified BS. Really shameful, quite frankly, and frightening. Tony, go ahead.
Hey, thank you, Alex. Been a long listener. It's about 2009. And, you know, back since 9/11, I started to realize that something wasn't right. So I've seen the documentary, what was it called, Loose Change, and I started to see things. And as I worked in the news, you know, I just felt like a lot of these stories weren't given both sides. So as I became producer on a weekend newscast and the anchor, you know, I started adding little bits to the story and giving my sources, and then we had high ratings. I mean, it was incredible to the point where they didn't know why. So the viewers started emailing in, and then they were like, you know, he's got this information. So I get called into the office, and they say, hey, you need to stop putting this stuff into the stories because, you know, it's not approved by NBC. And I'm like, well, it's, you know, we have to share both sides of this story. So I think it's good journalism. Isn't that what we studied? They're like, no, it's coming from NBC. You just put it in the way it is. Don't change it. And I said, okay. I said, but, you know, we're going to lose ratings. I mean, you need to look at that. I mean, people love this information. Look, you're just being told don't do it. All right.
Absolutely. I mean, I want to hear the rest of your story, but for folks that don't know, local so-called news, and I want to change this while we're launching a TV system. I've been so busy fighting other fights, I haven't quite got that launch yet, but it's happening, folks. And it always, you know, good times seems to be in God's plan. But everybody should just put out their own news. It's inexpensive now to do it compared to what it was, so that stations, UHF, VHF, cable, have a choice and don't just spew, because it comes down in talking points. They load the teleprompter. It looks like your local trusted news person that's more trusted than national. Let's say 50% trusted local versus 6% national. But really, your local person is really a national repeater. And so you're witnessing people want both sides or three or four sides. They want it. It makes your ratings go up, but the media is still willing to kill itself to be able to maintain the political control, because they're not in the business of making money at the news level. They're in the business of making money for the larger global agenda and massive trillion-dollar banker bailouts. But finish the rest of the story. I apologize.
That's okay. No, and then, you know, the funny thing is I heard one of your other callers yesterday talking about, you know, you're trying to bring stories to the newsroom. And, you know, people just, you know, they look at you like you're crazy. Like, you know, you're one of those nuts. And I said, no, I said, look, here's information. Here's documentation. This is important stuff. So they're like, then you get labeled. So then you're kind of labeled in the newsroom. And you're kind of an outcast. So they thought the best way to, you know, help me not put out the message was to put me on a morning show and make it fun. Yeah, he's got a good personality, you know.
Sir, that's a handbook. When they walked in at Shamrock Communications, I had the number one show in talk radio, period, in Austin. After 3 years on air, I'm 25 years old. I'm making them tons of money. And they said, you're going to do an entertainment show now in the morning, or we're going to fire you. And I said, I can't stop. And 6 weeks later, they fired me with pleasure. And they said, because you're talking bad about Bill Clinton. Now, I'd already started my other show, so it didn't matter. But I have experience where you're going to do entertainment now, buddy. Do you understand? Or next, you're fired. Please continue.
So then it was right around the time the NDAA was signed, and it was in the newscast, which I didn't produce. You know, I could only add the promos and the teases. And then I figured, well, since I can't really put it in the script, well, here's an opportunity. We're going to go to a two-shot. So I go to the two-shot and say, hey, you know, a lot of folks don't really know what that stands for, what those acronyms mean. And then I explained a little bit about it. And then she just kind of looked at me, my co-anchor, and just, I don't know, you're getting information. I'm like, well, it's out there. Here's a copy of it.
That's how brainwashed. They don't even want you to say National Defense Authorization Act. Like having info is now like evil. Oh, he's informed. You're not allowed to. NBC from New York sends it, and we just say it. He's talking on his own. We can't have that. See, it's programming, folks. Teleprompters down to us.
That's right.
And when Trump, you know, is forced to use one because it's his actual speech, that's fine. But when he's attacking it, he's saying, look, it's script written. It's coming down to them. So let me guess, what happened next?
Well, you know, I was no longer in the circle, and I was kind of an outcast. And I could just feel the pressure from beneath me, because when you make your way to that position, there's everybody on the bottom just gunning it just to put you out or to get you off. So I was no longer invited to the parties, and, I'd leave the newsroom, and I'd come back.
First they ostracize, then they dehumanize you, because they don't want to actually fire their friend. They have to learn to hate you first, because they're cowards, number one. So how did it end?
Well, it was about a couple of months into my second year, they decided to let me go. I was kind of having some health issues, so I went to the doctor. And, almost passed out. So they were giving me checks and everything. They say, hey, look, don't go to work. And they figure, well, maybe the morning show isn't for you. It's too early. So I presented that to my bosses, and they delayed me coming back. And then before you know it, I get a letter saying I'm gone. And, there's like 30 reasons why you could be let go. Like if you're a kid and you're suspended from school, you're suspended because you bit or you spit on somebody. But in this case, it was a general term for like, just general, misconduct.
Got it. I got to jump. But thank you for your testimony. We want to get more of those testimonies. God bless you, Tony, because that's what goes on behind the scenes, where we had newspaper reporters on about this, and they're just like, yeah, we all get in a room, and they go, we're going to lie about Trump, just make stuff up, everybody go get him. I mean, they don't even, Assange is a real liberal, like a really person I respect, who actually is a liberal, not a KKK person masquerading as a liberal. He's like, this press climate, we're all in danger. Hillary is a monster. I mean, it's like, why is it's so shameful to see this level of control. And they're only destroying themselves in the process.
Yeah, and the foundation is an example of how corruption just breeds more corruption. You would think you're the third most important person in America, and you still want to be more corrupt. You have no reason to be corrupt. But it's so much more out there to that. And I think as far as the black population and minorities, period, I think they see that, and I think that they don't want to vote for a crook, and they'll probably vote for Donald Trump.
Well, sure, and in a lot of polls he's way ahead, but those are the scientific polls, the big fake ones they put out, where they had 15% more.
Come on,
Reuters admits they had 15% more Democrats in the poll, and then Hillary's winning by 15 points.
No,
I mean, it's like they don't, but because they put the methodology out, It's like, it's okay. Oh, we stack the deck, but we admit we do, so it's all right.
Mm-hmm.
What?
No, yeah, it's not a true. The only way you know that the true vision is looking at it under undoctrinated lenses is if you're on the ground. And I'm on the ground, brother. And I'm in the hood, no mistaking. And these individuals are walking around talking about, I'm going to vote for Trump. And it has very little to do with what it is that they can get from him. It's what it is they've been waiting for. They've been waiting for a change and a growth. They didn't get that from the previous administration. And they feel abandoned by the current administration. And so they're going to do whatever they can to take
the battle. I'm seeing on the streets. I mean, I would say half the black people I talk to say they like Trump, but they're almost embarrassed. Like, well, Alex, I can tell you, but you know, my neighbors don't like it. And so yes. I think if people just get past this fear and come out of the closet.
That's right. That's right. And I talked about that, you know, in the speech. And I'm hoping that Donald Trump will bring more black surrogates at these rallies so that you can dispel the myth that blacks aren't coming out. And I'm not talking about like entertainment, you know, Alex. I'm talking about giving a real speech to people. That's what the kind of surrogate he needs out there right now.
Absolutely. He needs to absolutely hammer the daylights out of the globalists. The problem is a lot of times he does, the media just doesn't cover it.
Yeah.
So we have to get the videos. We have to get the raw
That's
stuff.
Right.
We have to put it out like InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com and DrudgeReport.com are doing. And that's why they say they want to censor Trump. You know, I mean, they have these fake debate coming up where he's back-to-back with Hillary, but then he doesn't get to ask her questions. That's not a debate.
No. She's been quiet with over 260 days now.
Listen, I really believe she's got serious health problems. And the word is brain tumor. The brain tumor was removed back in 2012, and then it's growing back. So that's why she is not looking too hot. That's the word, brain tumor. We'll be back.
Of safety for all citizens is paramount to both the United States and to Mexico. Number three, dismantling drug cartels and ending the movement of illegal drugs, weapons, and funds across our border. This can only be done with cooperation, intelligence and intelligence sharing, and joint operations between our two countries. It's the only way it's going to happen. Improving NAFTA, number four. NAFTA is a 22-year-old agreement that must be updated to reflect the realities of today. There are many improvements that could be made that would make both Mexico and the United States stronger and keep industry in our hemisphere. We have tremendous competition from China and from all over the world. Keep it in our hemisphere. Workers in both of our countries need a pay raise very desperately. In the United States, it's been 18 years. 18 years. Wages are going down. Improving pay standards and working conditions will create better results for all, and all workers in particular. There's a lot of value that can be created for both countries by working beautifully together. And that, I am sure, will happen. Number five, keep manufacturing wealth in our hemisphere. When jobs leave Mexico, the U.S. or Central America and go overseas, it increases poverty and pressure on social services, as well as pressures on cross-border migration. Tremendous pressure. The bond between our two countries is deep and sincere, and both our nations benefit from a close and honest relationship between our two governments. A strong, prosperous, and vibrant Mexico is in the best interests of the United States and will keep and help keep for a long, long period of time America together. Both of our countries will work together for mutual good and, most importantly, for the mutual good of our people. Mr. President, I want to thank you. It's been a tremendous honor, and I call you a friend. Thank you.
That was a very, very serious olive branch. It was common sense. It's what Trump really represents. But when America's been walked all over, mean, there are more Chinese a week coming in than there are Mexicans, and they admit they come here, and CNN reports on like it's a good thing to have babies free and to get citizenship. And the articles, when you read them, say, strangely, it's mainly wealthy Chinese. Well, yeah, we've got better hospitals. And you just come on a couple-month vacation, and you have your baby, and it's all paid for. And then the baby's a citizen. Nobody else lets you do that. But Germany and places like that, because they're absolutely trying to bankrupt and create division. That's wrong. I can't go to China and get stuff free. It's not racist. And I'm not even going to play race card on that issue. I mean, I could. Like, I'll hypothetically play it. And I'm not racist against Asians. My sister's Korean, adopted. I love Asians. Of course I do. Point is, I don't have to sit there and preface it with that. But you know, I show up in China and say I have my baby free, they would arrest me. If you smart off the Chinese police, they cut your testicles off in the street. Seriously, look it up. They just walk you over, cut your testicles off. That's what they do. Look it up. All right, drudgereport.com has a Daily Caller article linked up that the first debate isn't a debate at all. It's an event where Hillary goes back to back with Trump, two different stages, and they take basically pre-screened questions. You can bet your bottom dollar on that. Now, they said they're going to have other debates that'll be actual debates. We'll see if that happens, because she never goes out on stage more than 15, 20 minutes, and she never speaks more than about 8 minutes. Now, I've got somebody who I'm a huge fan of. I know most of you are probably fans. I know Buckley here in the office is a huge fan. And years ago, it hanged Dilbert cartoons on his wall. In fact, had a whole wall of them. Dilbert creator endorses Hillary out of fear for personal safety. Remember that article that Don Salazar wrote back on June 6th? So many death threats, so many attacks. Okay, I will support her. You bet. Please back off. And, of course, that's tongue-in-cheek in my view. We're going to talk to the man himself here in just a moment. But imagine even his lighthearted cartoons got massive threats. Can you imagine the threats we get? Can you imagine? I've never seen this level of behavior. And the New York Times calling for Donald Trump to be killed. So I thought we'd play a little boil down, because why this guy's even more interesting, not just for his cartoons, but all the predictions he's made that have come true sometimes decades before. Really uncanny. So obviously a smart guy. We're going to be going to him here in just a moment. Here's a short boil down of Scott Adams, the creator and artist behind Dilbert, looking into his crystal ball.
Joining me to talk Trump is Scott Adams. He's the creator of Dilbert. Again, Scott, on his blog, has been analyzing the rise of the Republican frontrunner for months now. And frankly, he has some of the most interesting and accurate observations about why Trump is appealing to so many people.
And I called him to be the landslide winner in the general election last year, because the tools he's using, essentially he's basically taking a flamethrower to a stick fight. There's nobody using the same tools he's using.
So you have another theory about Trump saying that he uses certain words and almost hypnotizes the audience. What do you mean by that?
So, for background, I'm a trained hypnotist, and I've been studying persuasion all of my life as part of what I do for a living as a writer. And I noticed back in August of last year that Trump was using persuasion techniques to perfection when it looked like he was just a crazy clown saying random things. But if you look at his method from a trained persuader's point of view, it's been perfection from the beginning. It just looks random to someone who's not trained and had a persuasion. His complete ignoring of facts are actually part of the persuasion, because he doesn't give you targets. He doesn't give you details of his policies, usually. So he's reducing the number of targets while making you feel good and focus on the things he wants. So it's not about facts. It's about focus and attention.
Is this like what you're talking about when you say, like, the linguistic kill shot, whether calling Jeb Bush low energy or something else?
Yeah, so the linguistic kill shot is finding some kind of insult, if you can call it that, that sticks like other insults would not. And he likes to pick things that are visual. You look at the person and say, yeah, that feels kind of right. But he also picks words and phrases that haven't been used before, so they haven't been polluted by other meaning, which is a good technique. So when you say somebody's low energy, there's nobody else that you ever talked about like that.
When I heard low energy, I called...
Low energy, right.
Yeah, I called the end of Bush that day. Because that is a sticky insult. So these are not random insults.
I'm not saying they're random. I'm not saying they don't work. I'm just saying he brands people. Well, low energy, crazy, crooked.
No, but there's something else to it. He's working on confirmation bias. When you see anything come out in the news that looks like maybe Hillary Clinton did something a little bit suspicious, you say, crooked Hillary. The brilliant thing he did recently was he came up with a second one for Clinton. He said, well, is she heartless? Is it a heartless Hillary? Or is it crooked Hillary? And he actually made people debate whether she was more heartless or more crooked. And that's all intentional. This is all technique.
Because Democrats like to say that they'd love to run against Trump. You clearly think that they're underestimating him.
Yeah, based on his talent stack alone, if you look at any individual talent he has, you could say, well, that's not the best in the world. But look how many he's put together. He knows strategy, business strategy. He knows negotiating. He's the best persuader I've ever seen. He's quick in his feet. He's funny. He's smart enough. He knows enough about politics. So when you put that stack together, nobody really stands up to that stack. I've been predicting he's going to win in a landslide since last year.
Not just the nomination, but the presidency.
Yeah, I think it'll be one of the biggest margins of victory in history.
There you go. Now Scott Adams joins us. Scott, I've got to say that I think a lot of what you would call trained programming is actually just instinctive in alpha males and leaders. And sure, he's gotten better at it. And made it more technical over the years as a manager and a salesman. But people think all the time I'm doing trained stuff. I was never trained in anything. I really mean what I'm saying. I think the missing element of what you were saying there is, it is true she's crooked. It is true she's obviously got health problems. Even Obama's doctor. I mean, I think what really makes Trump powerful is that he's telling the truth. And yes, sometimes he does simplify it. What do you say, Scott Adams, creator of Dilbert, blog.dilbert.com?
Well, people can't tell the difference between the truth and something that's totally made up. That is one of the powers we don't possess. What we do instead, and this is something you need to understand to be a hypnotist, is that people are irrational all the time. So what we really think is truth is usually confirmation bias. Now, things can be true also by coincidence, but usually we individuals don't have access to the base facts. We're just hearing it from somebody else. We're putting it together from clues in our environment. So most of what we recognize to be truth is really just confirmation bias. And this is true on both sides, by the way.
I agree for the general dumbed-down public. But, we deal in the real, the real system, the real program of how culture is set up and operating and the different competing systems. And I find Trump to be very, very accurate, very, very on target. I mean, his speech in Mexico, that had a lot of facts in it.
It did, and that's part of his persuasion. Because if you look at what the other side was trying to do to him, they're persuaders, and I think there's one in particular who's probably behind it. I've speculated that Robert Cialdini, who's famous for writing the book Influence, who would be one of the best influencers in the world, might be consulting for Clinton. He did help Obama's campaign, so it would be odd if he wasn't helping this time as well. But the situation that they'd set up is a confirmation bias trap that they built around Trump that made his opponents think that everything he did was one of these things. It's either crazy or uninformed or it's racist or it's another sign of his thin skin and his bad temperament. So they've set up a bunch of confirmation bias traps that everything he does can be interpreted to be one of those things if you're already inclined to think that way. So that's how persuasion works. Now, it's the same technique that Trump uses in the other direction. But so what he needed to do to try to wiggle out of that trap is try to do anything that showed he is well-informed, at least on one topic. And I think having 10 bullet points and talking about it for, I don't know, how long you talk, 45 minutes or an hour, I think he sold that. So the people who said Trump can't learn, he doesn't care about the details, he's not serious.
Wasn't it a daring and really smart move to go to New Orleans and the flooding when Hillary wouldn't, to go to Mexico and then say, you know, get down here, Hillary?
Yeah, that's great optics, because he's also working on the impression, which he's created, that Hillary doesn't have the stamina.
Plus, it looks presidential when he's standing next to a president.
Yeah, so he's got all the optics right. And that also works toward the, is he a crazy racist? Because you see him talking to the president of Mexico, and the two of them are getting along fine. You know, it didn't turn into a slap fight. You know,
the Mexican president's body language after the meeting was he really suddenly liked Trump.
Well, everything I hear about Trump in person is that people do like him in person. His personality is a little bit different in public, and it's even different again at a rally than it is at a press conference.
Yeah, so no, Trump. I mean, the Trump people see on the trail and stuff is Trump, but the Trump behind the scenes is like, I mean, the guy's got amazing charisma, and he's very smart.
That's what I hear. And by the way, the definition of charisma, according to the scientists, is kind of interesting. Charisma, say the experts, is the combination of power plus empathy. Now, he's already got the power, so people already saw that. And if they didn't see that, they saw him just annihilate the competitors in the primaries, and so now they believe he has power.
And can't we have this guy's president? I mean, this is awesome. He's got to be president.
Well, hold on. Part two is where his problem was. He had the power for charisma, but he lacked the empathy because he was taking a hard-nosed approach to immigration and other topics. And so that made him look like, well, maybe he's a little
scary. But don't you think that's the tactic, is to be, you know, the good cop, bad cop? He's first the bad cop, now he's the good cop.
I think he needed a different tactic in the primaries, of course, and he needed to soften it in the general. And he's well on his way to doing that. So I think his immigration speech was a huge step.
Well, sure, Scott Adams, I would love to have you on sometime just about your, you know, the technicals, being a hypnotist, you know, all your amazing you know, comics, Dilbert.com, blog.dilbert.com. But specifically, though, you saying you got so many threats, so you endorsed Hillary, and I can see here you're kind of, I don't want to say riding the rail, but I think you like Trump. I mean, I think it's obvious that you want Trump to be president, but in this media climate of censorship and persecution, you're just giving him backhanded compliments.
That's not exactly true. I'm actually completely serious when I say that I'm endorsing Hillary Clinton for my physical safety, and it's working. So prior to saying that publicly, I was getting comments online, mostly on Twitter, comparing me to Joseph Goebbels, you know, Hitler's PR person. And
but in reality, it's Nazi Germany where you have to endorse Hitler or Hitler comes after you.
Yeah, you can make that argument. But the point is that if I wanted to talk about Trump's persuasion skills, which is the thing that interested me and my audience, I couldn't do that with physical safety if people imagined that that also meant I backed his policies. And so let me say as clearly as I can that my personal political preferences don't align with either Clinton or Trump. I'm not very close to either of them on anything. So if you say, who would I prefer to be president on an entertainment basis, of course Trump. On a policy basis, I'm not smart enough to know who's got the best policies.
Bottom line, they're creating a new McCarthyism, but with no teeth, claiming that everyone, I mean, Hillary has actually said in her speech when she attacked myself and others last week, that the alt-right and Breitbart and others and Trump actually take orders from Vladimir Putin. I mean, I've never been to Russia. It's total bull. I've been on Russian TV. I've been on Japanese TV and British TV more than Russian TV. I'm not taking orders from the British either. I've been on Mexican TV. I'm not taking orders from the Mexicans. I mean, this is a new level. Talk about conspiracy theories. And then she made up stuff that I supposedly stand for or twisted it and then said, what type of dark heart? In fact, I'm going to play this clip for you. What type of dark heart does Alex Jones have and clutched her heart? Clearly, it was scripted. I want to ask you, as a top hypnotist, I know you're famous for that as well, what you think of this bit of propaganda. Here it is.
What happens in somebody's mind, or how dark their heart must be to say things like that? But Trump doesn't challenge these lies. He actually went on Jones's show and said, your reputation is amazing. I will not let you down. This from the man who wants to be president of the United States.
told, we haven't found it yet, but I got tweets and calls about it. Obama shot his mouth off at some dinner about me last night. But, I mean, this is really getting weird when she's talking about dark hearts and clutching her heart. I mean, what do you make of that neuro-linguistic programming?
So you notice that right after the GOP convention, as soon as Trump got done talking, all the pundits started using the same word, dark. That's not a coincidence. That comes from somebody who's trained in persuasion on their side. And again, it's probably Cialdini. And what dark does is it primes you. And this is something Cialdini writes about in his new book called Persuasion, which is coming out in a few weeks, and you should definitely buy it if you want to understand anything about the election. It sort of primes the viewer for anything that comes after fitting the mold of dark. So it's a linguistic kill shot of its own type, and it primes you to see everything in this tinged dark way. But you notice that 6 months ago, Clinton's selling points were she's the one with the experience and the facts and the, you know, she's the rational one.
The history, she's the safe one, she's the steady hand, even though she starts all these illegal wars and creates failed states. Let's expand on that, because Assange, we have this clip coming up later after you leave us, but it's on Infowars.com. WikiLeaks did a New York Times interview, and he said, listen, this woman's a demon. I've got the email. She's super dangerous. She's a mobster. She's going to hang the press, because they are. I've got stacks. She said in a campaign letter, they're going to shut down the alt-conservatives. I mean, this is bold. I'm holding the Daily Caller article with the snippets of the email right here. They actually say we have no right to exist. Talk about Hitlerian. Talk about Final Solution. And Assange says, he finally gave a hint. He said, well, a lot of it is how they're coordinating everything. It's all coordinated. Well, the earlier emails show that, where they're ordering everybody exactly what to do. I mean, this is not what you have in a free society.
Well, let me say, you're talking maybe about the WikiLeaks memo about CNN and their producers talking in advance before the interviews. That's what you're talking about.
There's a bunch of them. There's thousands of these emails, yes. But coordinating what to do. I mean, you pointed out how within 1 minute of the end of Trump's speech, it was dark, dark, dark everywhere. Articles already written. These talking points go out.
All right. But let me say, just on the point of CNN and the producers, it is normal business for them to discuss in advance what the questions are. They do that with me. They do that with most of the guests. I don't know that they would do that with the, if they had one of the candidates on, there might be more preparation there, or less preparation, just so they could surprise
them. There's more coordination than that. I mean, they were like sending people to go after Trump with Bernie Sanders support, people dressed up as Bernie Sanders supporters. There's a lot of coordination. I'm not sure which email you're...
Sure. I'm not saying that there isn't some of that going on, but there's also some confirmation bias.
Sure.
We see it where it isn't as well as where it is.
No, I hear you. And for folks that don't know about that particular term, why don't you define it for them?
So confirmation bias is where you've already made up your mind that something's true, and then any evidence you see in your environment, whether it supports that fact or not, you imagine that it does. So imagine you've decided that Trump is a racist, then if he talks about something like border security, which really doesn't have anything to do with the race, it's just something you do with all your borders all the time, every country.
Sovereignty.
Then you just say to yourself, well, that's probably another example of him being a racist, because I already decided.
Sure, no, they say he wants to put gay people in prison and ship blacks back to Africa, and it's all totally made up.
Yeah, that's as made up as it could be. But on the Clinton side, there's clearly some coordination with the mainstream media, but probably a little bit, over-imagined as well.
Two years ago, Congress legalized the CIA and being involved in domestic propaganda operations. They call it propaganda placement. Well, I coined that term. They call it behavior placement. And it's Congress ruled it was illegal 10 years ago, but said stop, funding it. But it's only expanding. So I think there's deeper layers to this. But obviously, this confirmation bias, famously.
Wait a minute, you think the CIA is involved in trying to influence the election?
Oh, absolutely. Here, I mean, they've had the former CIA directors and others come out and demonize Trump. I have the Washington Post on screen. U.S. repeals propaganda ban, spreads government-made news to Americans. I mean, it's full on.
Well, the government-made news is for which purpose? I mean, that doesn't necessarily mean it's nefarious.
2 years ago, they authorized domestic PSYOP operations. It's a fact. I've interviewed the police chiefs. Everybody, Delta Force comes in with big bags of money, buys off the local mayor. It's all part of COG.
For what messages?
Just to be prepared during a collapse or civil emergency to go with the particular party in power. It's pre-preparation, kind of like the Nazis did in France for about 3 years before they invaded. They had almost the whole general staff already paid off, ready to stand down. The Blitzkrieg really didn't do anything. The French just stood down. And that's a historical fact. It's just not widely circulated.
Okay.
Only the British fought, and then they got beaten and sent to Dunkirk, and you know, had to have the famous naval flotilla escape.
Do you think we're close to martial law and Obama trying to retain power?
I don't think Obama's going to try to maintain power, but the establishment power structure, like Goldman Sachs, that actually installs leaders, presidents, and prime ministers in Greece and Italy now, at Davos, they've called for a move to technocracy and basically installing bank heads as presidents.
You know, I think we ought to take a look at our system of government. If you ask me, it's already changed in ways that the founders didn't plan.
Exactly. You know, it's a soft martial law.
Well, I'm going a different direction here. I'm saying that, you know, we're a republic by design, but because of the internet, a good idea can bubble up from any individual. If it gets viral, then the mainstream media has to pay attention to it. And if they pay attention to it, there's a good chance it's going to become policy. So I would argue that we have devolved into something closer to a direct democracy accidentally.
Maybe a direct democracy of multinational corporations voting with their campaign contributions. But
no, but I think Trump signals the end of that model that you just described.
I agree.
He wins. So the old model, and by old, I mean sort of right now, you know, last year is old. Was that the lobbyists and the big money people were doing everything and selling it to the public as they had something to do with the decisions. But now I think that's actually becoming true because of the internet. You can make enough noise in the internet, your argument can be good enough.
Oh, I agree. There's a giant tsunami of awakening and human empowerment coming, but there isn't a totalitarian pushback to that. That's what I was getting at. Scott Adams, really smart guy, blog.dilbert.com. I hope you'll come back with us sometime in the future. Are you still predicting a landslide for Donald J. Trump?
I am, based on technique, not policies, and it looks like Clinton's not going to make it to the end line, based on what she looked like yesterday.
So I don't think it's a conspiracy theory that she looks sick. Even Obama's former doctor, who's a Democrat, is saying she looks really bad.
Well, there's a lot of variability in her appearance, and that's what I pointed out. I'm not trying to be a doctor. I'm just making
She looks like hell. Scott Adams, one last question. Are you concerned, or have you heard, Homeland Security now is going to step in and run the election for the first time ever?
What?
I'm not kidding. Look it up.
Homeland Security is going to run the election.
Yes, sir. And here's the deal. You have a normalcy bias because you're a good guy. You don't think as evil as these people do, even though you're sophisticated and smart. I'm asking you to see that confirmation bias that's even bigger because you're not a psychopath. I really appreciate your time, sir. I look forward to speaking to you again.
All right. Thank you for having me.
Very informative guy. We'll be right back. Thought-provoking. Stay with us. Huge news straight ahead. John Ronson, who writes for The Guardian, New York Times, you name it, but I've known him forever. That's why I did the interview. And he's saying, yeah, no, I really felt the energy in Cleveland, like Trump was unstoppable, populism, you know, the Brexit had just passed, Nigel Farage, Anti-New World Order, but now I feel like the polls are against Trump and it's all dissipating. And I said, that's because you tune into mainstream media. That's not what's happening in the real world. They just need to create enough of a hoax so they can steal the election and make it look like Trump lost and keep all these arrested development people like children to go, nanny, nanny, boo-boo, you're for Trump the racist. And I'm driving around Austin, and I see stores everywhere, you know, selling, I mean, all over the place, selling, you know, Trump pinatas. But you got 100 people out there protesting against Trump, and 20-plus thousand in there, tens of thousands got turned away. We've got B-roll of all this. It's up on Infowars.com. I mean, it's massive. Joe Biggs, you were there. How many people got turned away? I don't think I've ever seen a traffic jam 2.5 miles back where you guys had to get out of the cars and walk in. I mean, this was crazy.
Well, I got there. Me and Michael Zimmerman were the first ones there that day. We got there around 1:30 in the afternoon, and there was already a line wrapped around the exposition center where they do the road.
And he wasn't going to speak till 7:30.
Yeah, until 7:30. There was a guy that was waiting in line, told me that they got there at 3 a.m, waited outside of the gate, outside of the exposition center, and then waited in line as they kept opening up the fences throughout that area so they could get closer and closer and be in front of the line. I mean, that's crazy. You don't see that at Hillary Clinton.
And let's understand, 2.5 miles away by the time Dew got there, hours before it stopped, they had to get out and walk in.
Yeah, they had to walk at the end of the road where you come out of the exposition center. There's this long road that goes about 2 miles to the left and 2 miles to the right, the straightaway, and it was lined with cars on both sides parked. Tons of.
That's a major highway.
Yeah.
I mean, it's out in the middle of nowhere, too.
That's where we do concerts at, the rodeo. A buddy of mine took one of those panoramic photos. I put it up on Twitter from the inside.
Yeah, we know this place well because we're out there all the time. I take my kids to see monster trucks, you name it. I mean, I've been in that facility 70 times. Willie Nelson, you name it.
I mean, I went in with the mindset, all right, we're in Liberal Austin. There's not going to be that many people here. And when I got there, my mind was just completely blown. To see that many people in an area that's so liberal, people coming from all over, you know.
But it's not. I've been there at the elections, and the state admitted we discovered fraud. It was all over the newspapers, and they said we're still certifying the election. It's not Democrat. Until now, it's the invasion port from the failed California op. They blow that. Now they're going to exploit the next sector.
You know, there was a video we posted, I believe it was yesterday, where they had this Trump impersonator guy that was on in the video, and he's walking around, and this guy's like talking to him, interviewing him. And he said, you know, do you get any backlash from coming out and being Trump and, you know, and speaking? And he goes, no. He goes, everyone comes up to me. They all want a picture. They all say they love Trump. He said, whatever you see on TV is a complete and total lie. It's BS.
But there are the 100 or so or 200, sometimes 500 when Hillary buses them in, which we said from our sources, now all confirmed, not Sanders people dressed up like Sanders to make his people look bad and make Trump look bad. Well, see, divide and conquer, folks. She's playing both ends, you know, to take them down. And there were slash tires, there were some people attacked, and as usual, it was the anti-Trump people doing it.
It was like when I went to the Trump rally in Dallas, when I was sitting out there in the middle of the protest, and the police officer came up to me, admitted that these guys had been bussed in.
We have video.
They pushed us over or whatever, pushed us out of the way, like, all right, you guys get out of the way. We want to get these agitators out of here so they can catch their bus and get back out of here. You know, this time, it was a smaller amount of people, 70 to 100 people, but they lived in this little neighborhood. It was right across the street. There was hardly anyone else that came from downtown Austin, from the liberal trendy area, from the surrounding areas. It was just the people who live in.
Now, in fairness, mainline brainwashed liberals are the laziest people on earth.
Oh, yeah.
So, there are hordes of them that don't like Trump.
Well, they were downtown dressed up like clowns, acting like clowns.
15 and 18-year-old women running around with communist outfits on, but didn't even know what planet they were on. Did you notice? They're like, we hate Alex Jones. They go, who? And they, but they didn't even know who I was. They were told to say that.
And they hate capitalism. Meanwhile, they're live streaming you from their iPhone, wearing their brand new Nikes. And
we ought to ship their butt to, I'm telling you, North Korea, man. You know, I almost had a headline change this morning. I rarely do that, but I don't like to be inaccurate. And I was watching a John Bowne report. It was a really good report. It's Trump protesters are traitors. And I went, you know, this really is a foreign global takeover. These people really are destroying the sovereignty of the country. These people really are American haters. They really are, should be deported to the country of their choice. Just if you want socialist utopias, go to Venezuela right now, where it's war in the streets, or go to another socialist country. How about North Korea? I mean, seriously, get your ass out, man.
We should definitely start one of those White House petitions to send these people to North Korea, all these communists who love it and talk about it. And then when you actually question them, they don't even know what the hell it is.
They go, Mao is who we want. Mao, the biggest mass murderer on earth.
The Hillary Clinton lookalike.
She does wear weird Communist Party outfits. Now, I want to get to some of these clips. Before we do that, you've got to start taking this. Joe, selenium is one of the biggest trace element minerals out there that people are lacking. The amount of energy you get electrochemically from selenium is life or death. I mean, when you've got enough selenium, it's amazing. Read the study for yourself. If you don't have enough selenium, if you're a male, it will take it from your brain that has to happen and give it to your testicles because your body says that, you know, that's first, which I kind of agree with, you know, God designed things correctly. anyways, the point is, if there's a literal correlation where they tell boxers and people, you know, don't have sex for a few months before your fight because, you know, the selenium issues. But I could go on for hours. The point is just try it for yourself. You can't lose. It's 1995. You're supporting the broadcast. It goes with X2. The two things work together synergistically. So does vitamin C. That's readily available, so we're not selling that, obviously, in bioavailable forms like orange peel and things like that. But you really need to get BioTrue Selenium, ladies and gentlemen. It supports the broadcast. It is super organic from the purest place you can get it. That is mustard seed, InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com. And Amerigeddon, the new film, $5 million budget, exposing a UN-style takeover. and a fictional account and an EMP attack is also available. Get a second copy of the film and get some of my films free with it at InfoWarsStore.com. That's InfoWarsStore.com is the general store. InfoWarsLife.com is on the same store, but that URL takes you right to the nutraceuticals. And look what InfoWars is doing. And I'll say this again. It's not about bragging. It's about you knowing mainstream media is there to make you feel like you're all alone on a deserted island. Mainstream media is there to make you feel like, because you believe in the right to self-defense or you believe in free market, that you're crazy. Everyone loves Mao, and Mao founded America, not George Washington. Okay, and Hillary's in the best of health, and 2 plus 2 equals 50, and the Easter Bunny's real, and Santa Claus loves you, and you visited with last night. All of this is just garbage. And that's why I say, get a Hillary for prison shirt, get an InfoWars shirt, get a Molon Lambe shirt, get a Bill Clinton rape shirt. And these Trump things are great because it's let InfoWarriors go experience what I've experienced. I'm walking down the street 10 years ago, and maybe one out of five people said, hey, Alex Jones. It's now, like when I was in London and stuff, I couldn't even walk down the street. In some cases, and people see this on live stream, I'm like walking down the street, live streaming, and Alex Jones, people all the world, Alex Jones, people from Poland, people from Russia, people from Japan, people from London, people from Pakistan, Alex Jones, Alex, and it's like, whoa. And again, it's not about, oh, look, I'm famous. I'm not singing songs here. That wouldn't matter if I was famous because of that. They are resonating and agreeing with our anti-globalist, anti-New World Order message. Well, you aren't famous, okay? But when you wear a Hillary for prison shirt or an InfoWars shirt, or a Drudge ought to sell shirts with DrudgeReport.com on it. Mm-hmm. I guarantee he'd sell 50 million of them. I'm telling you, Drudge needs to do that. He may already be doing it. It needs to happen. I would promote him. I mean, I ought to license Drudge, ask Drudge if I can sell him and, you know, split half the money with him. Because, I mean, we need to get these out. They need to support the independent media. And imagine, nobody's wearing Fox News, even though it's better than CNN. You don't see CNN shirts. You don't see MSNBC shirts. Why don't we have Drudge Report shirts? I mean, what I'm saying is that if you saw every 10th person wearing a Drudge Report shirt, like we're seeing in Austin with InfoWars, and bumper stickers almost on every corner, that citizens doing that, it flips the system out, and they understand that we are cutting through their signal, we're cutting through their blackout, we're cutting through their Iron Curtain, we're coming in with the real voice of America. You want to know what this is? This is the real voice of America, folks. Coming to you, of course, from Texas, baby, with Joe Biggs and the rest of the crew. So I'm ranting here, but the point is, you go to a Trump rally, and I've seen these videos, sometimes in a crowd, you'd be a third, always about 15% were wearing Hillary for prison shirts or InfoWars shirts. Imagine what that telegraphs to the system. And it's all over the country. It's all over the world. And that's just little InfoWars, Joe Biggs.
Zimmerman and I were at the Trump rally on Tuesday, and I had them bring me out two large boxes of those Hillary for prison bumper stickers.
I'm glad you thought of that.
And we filmed it. And people swarmed around us. We're like almost at the point of fighting over it. You know, and I was just...
Have we put that video out yet?
Yeah. And I was like, Clinton for San Quentin, Hillary for prison,
How many Hillary for prison shirts did you see? I saw a ton on the videos.
Oh, lots. I mean, way too many to even number. I mean, that's everywhere we go now, though. But I guarantee you there's...
I went to a Metallica concert, and they were, like, people were wearing InfoWars all over the place. I went to Dave Mustaine all over the place. Again, it's crazy.
There's going
to
be 3,000 new cars in Austin, Texas, and the surrounding areas with Hillary for prison bumper stickers on it. I mean, people were like, give me two. I've got to...
Why didn't I think of that? We should have hit him with 10,000, 50,000.
I got as many as I could, but I mean, there's going to be a lot more out there. And I think from now on at these events...
By the way, are those available yet on the site?
I don't know if you can buy them, but what they're doing is every time someone makes a purchase at the InfoWars store, they throw in two or three with their order as well, just as an added bonus.
Well, that's incredible. Well, good job to those folks. I want to get to some of these clips. What's the name of that video so they can pull it up on YouTube?
We'd have to look back at it. It shows a huge line of people waiting, and it says people go crazy for Hillary for prison or something like that, or Austinites go crazy for Hillary for prison, because I do a chant one, and then it's the one right after that where there's a huge line. It's 15 minutes long because we just let the camera roll. Because I walked all the way from the very beginning of the line to the tail end, and that was around 1:30 or 2.
That's another problem. We have so many great videos that a lot of them only get seen like 30,000, 40,000 people because we're putting 50 a day out.
Yeah.
I mean, which is still success, but this should be seen by everybody. I have been spending hours at night and during the day almost getting nothing done now, just trying to watch what you guys did, because it's all so informative and so entertaining.
Well, one of the craziest, my favorite video, it's not that long, but it's the Black Lives Could Care Less About Black Lives.
We're going to get to that in a minute, but first I want to just point out that you have won a Thug Life Award, and for folks that don't know what these are, tell Tell the listeners.
So it's whenever you basically do something that's pretty awesome. And
it's when you absolutely...
You essentially just have to like drop the mic and walk away because you just did something so epic. And then they started making these videos where it's like sideways hat drops on your forehead and big glasses with diamonds and like a joint and a machine gun in your hand. And they play like some Dr. Dre song in the background. So it's...
I think it's ludicrous.
Yeah. Maybe, I don't know.
The point is, get out the way. In fact, okay, here's the short clip and then we'll play the actual clip first. Yeah. Here it is.
If I go to Mexico right now illegally without citizenship and I don't have a passport, I will go to jail.
Good.
Okay. And then if you're illegal here, you should go to jail or be deported.
Okay, I'm waiting for somebody to put me in jail now.
Well, Donald Trump's going to do it. Stay tuned for more reports at Infowars.com. I'm Joe Biggs.
Now let's get serious and get back to the clips. Let's play the one you said you want to play first, and that is the Black Lives Matter clip. Black Lives Matter, not concerned with helping black lives. Here is Joe Biggs at the Trump rally.
How are you doing? So why are you guys out here?
Black Lives Matter! Black Lives Matter! Black Lives Matter!
So, if Black Lives Matter, did any of you guys go to Louisiana to help out?
Black Lives Matter!
Any of you guys go to Louisiana? Did you go to Louisiana to help out? Hey, you know who did go to Louisiana? Trump. You know who didn't go?
Black Lives Matter! Black Lives Matter!
Exactly, you don't have an argument.
Black Lives Matter! Black Lives Matter!
When's Black Lives Matter in Katrina?
You act like a child.
Black Lives Matter!
They didn't want to talk to the press. They never did. No one does. They're all sent by groups.
I said, except in Louisiana. Except in Louisiana.
Then go to Louisiana.
And the police in the background are just kind of like smiling because they're like, yeah, you're sitting here screaming and chanting, but you're not doing anything to save black lives. They're being murdered in abortion clinics. They're being killed by black-on-black crimes in Chicago. You're not doing anything. You're just sitting here and you're chanting. Meanwhile, there are people dying. So if you actually cared about black lives, you would get off your butt, do something, raise some money in Louisiana, go out there, get a boat, save people. Guess who went there? Donald Trump.
And it's now over 1,500 people shot in Chicago this year. Over 90% of them were blacks. That's over 1,000 black people shot, over 500, almost 600 dead. And you'll literally tell Black Lives Matter about that. They just don't even look at you. They don't even hear you. They don't even care. It's drugs being shipped into the neighborhoods. It's globalism. It's the deindustrialization. It's the MTV culture. It's why those neighborhoods are like that, not because of the cops. And we're not defending the police just out of hand. It's just a total scapegoat to destabilize these inner city areas. The Democrats are the main people doing it. Then they have the police that are the lowest level of the government. Throw them at it and then blame them like a rear guard action that it's their fault.
But why do you go and protest Donald Trump? He's the only one that went there. It took days for Obama to go out there because he was...
I don't need to be intellectual. You are a racist.
Have you seen the meme?
You're an effing white male.
Have you seen the meme where...
You're a white male!
There's a car underwater.
You're a white male!
In Louisiana.
And, you're a white male!
And Obama's standing on top of the car, and it looks like he's taking a chip shop, and it says, can I play through? And meanwhile, he's standing on top of a car that's submerged underwater in Louisiana, and it says, can I play through?
Well, that's okay, because he's black.
Oh, my God, it's ridiculous. But they're standing outside of this event, protesting the only person who went there, the person who went
there. What you say doesn't matter. You are a white male. We have people all over the country march up and say, safe space, white women, you name it. And they say, you are white, you're not allowed to speak.
University in Chicago today came out and said they will no longer coddle students at their university, that there will not be safe spaces anymore.
Oh, yeah, this mental illness is being exposed. Here it is, the college. This is the University of Chicago, very prestigious and very liberal. Our commitment to academic freedom means, this is from the dean, our commitment to academic freedom means that we do not support so-called trigger warnings. We do not cancel invited speakers because their topics might prove controversial. We do not condone the creation of intellectual safe spaces where individuals can retreat from ideas and perspectives at odds with their own. Again, welcome to the University of Chicago. See you in September. Sincerely, Jay Ellison, PhD, Dean of Students in the college.
I think they're getting a lot more students are going to sign up and want to go there.
Probably call for them to resign. A lot of these universities, they ban everything, like up in Missouri, apologize for everything, and then the president's people resign, and the protest continues.
Yeah.
And, of course, then they saw like a 30% drop in attendance. It's crazy, man. Who would pay $100,000 to send their young adult to one of these things.
I need my safe space.
Joe Beggs, we're going to break here in a moment, but I just want to tell you that things are getting crazier and crazier. What does your gut tell you about Trump? I mean, if he gets crowds of 20,000 people everywhere and Hillary can't even get 100, in fact, we should be showing some of that when we come back. I mean, her crowds are 200's a big crowd for her now. And now she's suddenly nowhere to be seen. She's supposed to give this speech about banning right-wing media, but she's canceled it? Or
it keeps getting delayed. I guess they're looking for stools and pillows to prop her up, maybe a couple more shots from her handler. You know, she's
Yeah, you got handlers walking around with a needle right behind her. You know, like in a mental institution when they take the real psycho out, they got a needle right there.
Like they're walking behind her and pat her on the back. And give her an
like a piranha dog or something. Oh my gosh, she's gonna have the nuclear weapons. Oh man, they tell us Trump is scary.
Yeah, we're gonna give him fake security.
This woman is obviously completely out of her mind. Just look at her. I was asking you during the break. Do you think Trump's going to win? And repeat what you said.
Slide. It's going to definitely be a landslide. You know, I've been all over the country to all these events, and when you see the amount of people that show up, the amount of people that come from other states and the surrounding states, other countries, it's amazing.
And notice, this is America. These are hardworking people that are motivated and will wait for hours and will drive to be a place. It sure proves they're the folks that actually do the work in this country.
Well, there's also
because, I mean, where are the jackass liberals? They can't even show up to protest. Hillary has to bus them in, and then they're so immoral, they'll actually wear the Bernie shirts they're ordered to have and then repeat the slogans they're given. What despicable, horrible slaves.
Well, there's also been a progression, though, as far as Trump supporters, too. You know, at the beginning, back when a lot of these violent riots, protests were happening, a lot of people were scared to wear Trump shirts out in public and hats. And now when I go out, all across the country, I'm seeing people in gas stations, at restaurants, proudly wearing Trump shirts. They're not an event. They just wanted to be out and wear it. You know, and for a while, people were kind of scared to do that. And you're not seeing that anymore because we're winning. We've defeated them already because people are seeing what we're showing here. The massive amounts of people coming.
Absolutely. Just give people a radar, sonar ping. You've been here, what, a couple of years?
Almost 3 years now.
Wow. How much do you notice now when you're on the street?
A good bit.
Like, on average, let's say you go downtown or airport.
You know, in Austin, you know, maybe 4 to 5 people. If I go like on Rainy Street or something, you know, but a lot of people will recognize my voice. And then they'll go, oh, Joe Biggs, because a lot of people don't watch.
It's constantly, in fact, exactly. I saw the cops come up the hike and bike trail the other day. They were ordered to give tickets to people down there because they closed it because of the flooding. And Pat Riley was with me and my son was with me. We were hiking. And I was shooting a video, and Pat goes, look, and the cops heard my voice and went, and the sergeant turns around and goes, we're not giving tickets. Stop. It's Alex Jones. Turn around. And we started getting it on video. But my point is that we get more people coming up to us than when I see mainstream media folks like Charlie Rose walking around in Cleveland. No one was coming up to him, so I ran over to him. He's walking around with thousands of people around him. No one wants to talk to Charlie Rose. He has a morning CBS show. Supposedly with 5 million viewers. No one even cares about it.
I saw him one of the days, and I just kind of went, oh, look, it's Charlie Rose. And then I just kept walking, you know, because there's really no connection there for me because he's not really promoting anything that I want to be a part of. It's just that I've seen him before. I've seen some of his shows, and I was kind of like, oh, look, he's there.
Exactly. People are almost emotionalist about the establishment media.
But when we go out to these events, like at the Trump rally, tons of people were coming up to us there.
And we had a lot of fans of the Democrat deal.
Oh, tons. I mean, it was ridiculous. The police in Philadelphia, I was walking by and this guy goes, yo, Biggs. And I looked over and it was two black cops on bikes and they were standing in front of the wall that was there to keep people out. And they're like, yo, man, tell Alex we said, hey, man, we love this show, man. We watch you guys all the time.
Well, I mean, I don't want to get in trouble, but we were cheered by the Secret Service like everywhere we went.
I had this really big tall guy come running at me in a bulletproof vest and he's got a gun in Philadelphia, and I was like, what the hell did I do? And this guy goes, can I get a picture? I love you guys. I'm like, hold on. Or it wasn't ATF, it was Homeland Security. And I was like, yeah, sure. He's like 6'8", and I'm like 5'9". And I'm sitting there like, all right, man, this next time, don't run at me so quick, man. I didn't know what was going on.
Trying to have a little PTSD there.
Yeah, right? I was like, what the hell, man? But it's everywhere. Like the Cleveland Police Department just loved us. I mean, just responsive. I mean,
yeah, well, don't tell people. Don't tell them. Anyways, it's pretty ridiculous. Pretty ridiculous. And again, that's got to worry Hillary.
Oh, definitely. I mean, I've been to her rallies as well, and it's very lackluster. Most of the people that go to her rallies are going to hear her lie in person because they just want to see that in person for once in their life.
And I want to be clear about something. We're going to hold over in the next hour. Anthony Gasciardi is going to be joining us from the other studio, from the radio studio. We're here in the TV studio. course they're bad cops. Of course they're bad people in every group. We want to reform some of the problems that the globalists brought into the police. But here's the deal. America's getting taken down by outside globalists. The proof's coming out in emails. And Americans are all rallying together, whether you're a cop, a citizen, black, white, it doesn't matter, Hispanic, together to try to save this country. Epic history's happening. And America's not flat-footed. We are awake. We're growing. And we're ready. 25 years ago, when I first got politically involved, I would go speak at city council because it was on cable and people would see it. I would go speak at the county commissioners, and I would bring up the New World Order, world government. I would read quotes by David Rockefeller about destroying our sovereignty, Senator Goldwater fighting back, and they'd laugh at me and make jokes. See, people aren't laughing now, and that's my point. As bad as stuff is, the police are awake because the globalists went too far with their Soros plan and started saying, go kill cops and stuff. And the police know about how they do this in third world countries. So they're like, oh, my God, the worst is true. The military's basically almost completely awake, unless somebody's really stupid. And they're in trouble, Joe Biggs.
Yes, they are. And with the military, that point being made, that's very true. You know, there's a lot of soldiers that I was in with that are still in who watch the show religiously, who watch it before I even knew the show existed back when I was in Iraq and like 2014 and stuff, that were watching this show and listening to your videos and watching your documentaries. And I didn't even know the show existed. Most of them thought I was such a gung-ho soldier.
When was this?
They were scared to tell me, like, back in 2013 all the way through 2013 when I got out. You know, I never knew the show existed until after I got out with the whole Hastings thing.
Yeah.
You know, but most of the soldiers wouldn't even come to me and tell me about it because they thought I was such just a gung-ho U.S. Army by the book, you know, Rambo type guy. And when I got out and started working here, everybody just started emailing me and calling me like, you work for Alex Jones. That's the most amazing show ever.
I was about to add, though, that's compartmentalization. Everyone feels like they're alone. We're all decompartmentalizing right now and realizing, hey, we're the majority. And we're not black. We're not white. We're patriots.
Well, I mean, I did a report earlier this week on Monday where the U.S. Army had a OPSEC brief. And in the slide, it listed Hillary Clinton as a security threat, with her mishandling of classified materials, along with General Petraeus and all that.
And notice they said no comment, which means it's real.
Well, the story that I came out with was Monday. Later Monday night, the Army pulled the slide from their briefs that had been going on for almost over a year. Then Tuesday, NBC covered it. Then Wednesday, the Army came out yesterday in Army Times and said that they pulled Hillary Clinton.
Oh, see, I didn't know that, but I said, no, that's real. Because when they say no comment, that means real.
Oh, yeah, it was real. It was a real slide that was in circulation for about 18 months, and the Army pulled it down after the backlash from the videos.
Well, that's because the Army is openly ignoring Obama and Hillary at this point because they're not our leaders. They are foreign imposters. General Flynn, all of them know, folks. I mean, this is a big deal. It's a soft coup as Pachenik. And Pachenik's been running around to the generals and stuff. They've been meeting and things. That's the thing. People, the listeners and stuff, I don't tell people a bunch of stuff because it's so historic, so over the top, that I can't even believe I'm in the middle of it. But just believe me. The only reason I'm alive is the good Lord above, but also there's so many good people and agencies that I'm under full surveillance for my own safety. I mean, I've been told in the threat fusion centers and stuff, everything I do is watched. And that's to protect me.
Yeah.
Is that not crazy?
I believe that 100%. When I go and I go to do some of these reports and these police come up to us or the FBI contacts me and says, hey, we're watching you in Mexico when you're going down there looking at this. What did you find out? You know, they're watching.
Yeah, and so I realized the PSYOP, they come in, corrupt our government, take it over, have the government do bad stuff, and then have us have a war with our government, so they come in after. No, we're not doing that. We've caught you. We know your plan. You are screwed, Soros. You are screwed. And I played along with fighting with the cops and stuff before I paradigm shifted in the last decade, and it's just part of getting older and more sophisticated. And we're all learning more faster and faster now, too.
Yeah, it's not flip-flopping. As you get older, you start to understand the world better. You start to see behind the curtain. You start to understand everything clearer. And that's what the show does. Is it kind of, imagine being born with a pair of glasses on, but they're really foggy. And as time progresses, you start cleaning them off and you start to be able to see clearer and clearer. And eventually you get to a point where it's all clear and you can see it. And it's scary. But
it's like you're driving through the mountains and you go through the cloud cover. All of a sudden you're up above the clouds. You see the blue sky and the mountains and the moon rising. And you're like, this is incredible.
Yes.
And that's what it's like. It's just more and more. We're just like, whoa, we can see for miles and miles and miles, hundreds of miles. And we're all seeing this together.
Mm-hmm.
We're all sharing the same truth. Well, Salon that normally is promoting pedophilia and how great it is to lust after four-year-old girls. I'm not kidding. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is like something that is a running theme with these people. It's a war on decency. We have to bring them to heel. Watch a decade of Hillary Clinton's shameful hypocrisy on racism, and they make a joke out of it. You know, it's like when I talked about Uma Abedin. Has she had sexual mutilation? Because her parents are serious Muslim scholar clerics, and her mother promotes Sharia law, which means you cut a woman's genitals off. And they had, I'm not exaggerating, at least 10 national news stories and newspapers, you name it, attacking me and Roger Stone for saying, who knows, does she have her genitals? And they said, oh, we're obsessed with women and don't know about women and are digging through our sister's underwear drawer. And these articles all kind of, because I read like 4 or 5 this morning, were like fetishy, like they kind of liked it. It was like they were playing to their pervert readers. We're like, serious, man. This woman runs around these flower outfits and stays in the same hotel room with Hillary and all this. We're not saying it's bad that they're lesbians, whatever. The point is that then they support Sharia law that would kill a lesbian. That's what we're talking about, media, Blue State, all you different newspapers and publications. Not that, oh, we're obsessed. Well, we are obsessed, but the point is not obsessed like we don't know anything about it, like we're trying to discover something. I mean, give me a break. These people are crazy, Biggs.
It's Stockholm Syndrome. They loved, yes, please, let's support Sharia law and the Islamic terrorists. Please cut my head off. And they just guide the guy's hand holding the blade up to their neck, and they just love it. And they're smiling and giggling.
And they have writers that sit there drooling and then showing videos of four-year-old girls. I mean,
that was sick. I saw that. This guy comes out with this video and says he's a pedophile and he doesn't want to be looked at like he's inhumane or he's some bad person. He's like, I've never really done anything with a child, but I do have sexual fantasies with young girls. No, that's completely and totally messed up. We should not be promoting that.
Meanwhile, the same liberal media says arrest a guy if he's 18 and his girlfriend's 17. No, that they should amend the statutory rape laws, okay? But when it's a guy going after, you know, your five-year-old daughter, execute them.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it is just the craziest stuff. I mean, let me tell you, when I was 16, I had girlfriends that were 25. And that was not statutory rape, I'll assure you. I'm not trying to get graphic. It's just true. I'm not bragging. It is true. I tell you, what a crazy world. I wish I was as good looking as I was when I was 20, though.
I remember when I used to live in Panama City Beach, was out of time.
Oh, my gosh. Well, I'm sure. Here's the deal. They call it perverted, and they control the Christian churches. Because I'm a Christian. I love God. But I'm a man. I mean, God made me. Look at all stuff King David did. I'm just not a hypocrite about it. It's normal that I appreciate God's creations, you know, full-grown women. That's supposedly, Christians get more upset when I talk about how beautiful women are, but then it's like they're promoting pedophilia on the news, and we've allowed Christians to kind of lose the moral high ground by getting so upset at, like, you know, men liking women in bikinis,
you don't
then going out and screaming, you know, God hates fags, kill gay people, to make Christians, you know, not look loving. And then meanwhile, you give away your moral high ground and the pedophiles come out and take over.
You don't want to see
beekeepers. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, you don't want to see beekeepers in the water playing around and swatting the water and chasing after the bees.
Well, by the way, it's true that when they put these burkinis on, in fact, I had an article on that today. In fact, let's pull that up if we can on screen. When they have these burkinis on that are literal Teletubby outfits that full-grown women are wearing, and they're out there at the beach, the French are like, but the thing is, they grandstand. And Bracken talks about in the next phase of Islam, they do this to parade around and make you uncomfortable. And see, they enjoy it. They get off on it. These are Stockholm Syndrome enslaved women with their genitals cut off in many cases. But the inventor of the burkini has now come out and attacked Sarkozy, who's a bad guy, by the way, for supporting the burqa ban, and said, you don't get the style. Can we pull up close-ups of the burkinis, please? I mean, not just the faraway shot, but these women look like they're wearing giant condoms or something.
The one lady, she had like a beehive in her hand or something. Like, tried to fill the holes with sand or something to kill the bees, I guess.
The point is that here's the deal. You come to France, the inventors of the bikini, not much good about
the French. How are you going to surf in that?
Now, the French are great people, actually. Their socialists are horrible. Look at this. What is the point of going to the beach? And they'll say, oh, don't bully. These are people that want to bully my women. They'll say, that's sexist. Yeah, you're right. They're my women. My family, my daughters are mine. They're not putting on your damn beekeeper outfits. Ain't happening, Jack.
We want them to be free. We want them to dress how they want to dress. They should have.
That's because you're a racist, sexist, homophobe.
Islamophobe, which is why I'm still alive.
Look at this. I mean, look at this. I mean, it's a clown outfit. Look at that.
I like the Teletubby.
Look at this. Look at this. Hey, Anthony Gucciardi, I'm going to bring you in right now.
Oh, this is going to be like
a
secret photo shoot.
Anthony, we make the joke that sunglasses, cars, and suits are all best when they're Italian, and shoes and everything else. But I tell you, maybe we have an Italian designer of burkinis. Would that make it okay?
I think that must be it. And did you see that they said now if you post a picture of someone enforcing the burkini law, and, like, writing a ticket or whatever, they're going to come after you legally?
The
French government. I have the article right here. It says it.
Trendy.
That's totally schizophrenic. Exactly. They tell the newspapers, okay, we're going to enforce the law, but we don't want to, so don't show the photo. Go ahead and show the article. Here we go.
Everything is so loaded. Perception becomes reality. It's totally insane. They could just say anything they want, say you're racist, say you're homophobic. Yeah, it's from The Independent. I sent it to the producer. It says,
yeah, let's do a document cam shot. We can show that in there.
Burkini ban. France threatens legal action against social media users for sharing photos of police enforcing law. So it says, I am denouncing a manipulation that undermines the local police. And they're threatening legal action against social media users for sharing photos of police enforcing a ban on the burkini, which is one right here.
But it's a public place, so there's no perception of privacy. That's my big beef with police worldwide. I get that cameras cause you problems. They also help you in a lot of cases. That'll help get rid of bad cops. Stop giving people tickets or arresting people that are videotaping police. They've backed off a lot on that in the U.S. That is outrageous by the French.
I just love the ridiculousness of all of it. It's like, it's completely insane. Just like they had the burkini-only pool days. Well, now it's like, okay, well, we're going to put this policy forward, but then the other segments
come and say, oh, yeah, in Germany, they have pool days just for the Muslims.
Yeah, exactly. But now you can't even take a picture.
And they have the girls now in Germany wear wristbands at all the pools saying, don't rape me in Arabic.
And hey, also the Egyptian police, I couldn't print the story because it wouldn't work. The Egyptian police are using gay and lesbian dating apps, smartphone apps, and then busting the people using them and arresting them. But that's okay. That's fine, right? We're bad. Look at all the actually oppressive countries and the actually oppressive people. They're great, and we should defend their honor. In the United States, though, if you say something that could potentially harm someone, you're a really, really bad person. Like, you're bad. You said you're women. What you meant is you actually care about the women in your life, so you consider them so important to you that, you know, they're like your women in your life, like your mother or whatever.
They're mine.
But you're bad.
Me and McGreen were in Eugene, Oregon. And we're at this, like, Whole Foods site place where they had these little trendy restaurants in there, and we're covering one of the Trump rallies. And he was inside looking around at some of the stuff, and I walked
out. My spoiled
and room. There was this giant swarm of bees. And I kid you not, there's this lady in the whole Burke outfit, and everyone's, like, running from it. She just goes right through it, just breezes right through, like, nothing's even.
So there's the answer.
And she didn't get stung, and I was like, wow, it is a beekeeper suit. And I was like, McBree, look at this. It works.
Really? Where's this video?
There was no video. We were just walking to go get lunch, and I'd seen that, and there was just, like, thousands
of. Oh, my God. You actually saw a woman in a burqa
run through the, like, she walked right through this bee swarm. I mean, there was thousands. And there's a guy in this other, he was in an actual bee suit, and he's standing up on a ladder, and he's trying to get this nest down or hive down or whatever.
And by the way, let me say this. They use our open, truly liberal society as a joke to overthrow it. I can't go to Saudi Arabia, okay, with my family and say, have my daughters, you know, even in a normal bathing suit or anything. So why can't they walk down the street with their faces uncovered? Why aren't they open to me? Why do I have to be open to them? Do you understand that, fake liberals? Why do you think they're so cuckolded, Anthony? Why does the left want to commit suicide?
I love that word. Well, you know, here's the best. We should be able to make a joke about anything we want. We should be able to talk about anything we want. We have a joke. I'm 100% Italian. And what's our joke? We call me Shinebox. From the Goodfellas, go get your shine box. We make jokes all the time. Who cares?
Well, that is your idea to do that.
It's my, of course. Like, it's my joke.
Although whenever we do something really cool or something really successful, we'll go, look at this. And, or like we're in an Italian suit or something. We'll go, look at this damn shine boxer.
Exactly.
Look at that Lamborghini, those damn shine boxes.
Exactly.
Look at these Italian sunglasses. Look at these Italian women, these shine boxers.
Exactly. It's all a big joke. It's self-deprecating.
Exactly.
It's funny.
Because the thing is, a lot of Italians were poor, so they were the shine shoes, and that's in the movie Goodfellas, which is really true. Italians would insult each other and say, now get your shine box. So I mean, we make a big joke about it.
Right. It's not a big deal. It's funny. It's silly. It's not
actually
offensive.
Let's say we're getting
offensive
on a helicopter to go survey something. And we say, look at us. We're getting in a shine box.
Exactly. It's actually good nomenclature. It's real. But you see, we can say that it's funny, but then you even say the word burqa and people look at you, oh, because that's a hot issue right now. Oh, how dare you, right?
I hear people all the time go, let's get Mexican. They go, can't say Mexican. Or
yeah.
Let's get Chinese. Chinese, did you? Chinese are going to hear that.
No.
It's like mental illness, man. It is crazy.
People asked me specifically about you talking about you can't say Mexican, right? They're like, no one says that. One time we were talking with someone, I don't know who it was, and there was someone there that said, well, don't call it Chinese food. What are you supposed to call it?
What am I supposed to call it?
What are you supposed to call it?
I ordered Chinese last night. It was
delicious.
Literally,
it is called Chinese food on the sign of the place.
Okay, I'll tell the story, but it's a court case, and I'm not getting into it. It's a court case I was successful in, but it's the kind of stuff that goes on, okay? I am in a court, okay? This is this year, and I'm sitting there, and they bring up, they go, and then once he said, yeah, you know, that Hispanic guy. And then they were asking this Hispanically on the stand. They go, do you think that's racist? And she goes, no, he was Hispanic. It's like, you go, you know that farmer guy down the road, or you know that Hispanic guy, what's his name? It's like literally words. It's like if you say homosexual, it doesn't mean you hate gay people or heterosexual. It's the term.
What if police just stopped using descriptions, which they do now, actually? But you know how it's like,
Interpol, the UN are banning saying Muslim.
It's just
there's a human being right now. There's an active shooter situation right now. There's a human being on the loose. Find him. He looks like a human being.
And don't say the color of his car. We can't even say it's a car.
Don't say
what's
he.
What's the vehicle description?
He's driving a burqa.
What color Who knows is what he identifies with?
You can't even say he's wearing a beekeeper suit. They're wearing a Teletubby outfit. They're at the beach. It's a woman in a Teletubby outfit with... If religious groups want to cover themselves up and you know, not be out there in a bikini saying, hey, I'm ready to, you know, mate and, you know, find a man, that's totally reasonable. Like the Amish and folks. My issue is with the Islamists. This is part of a law, part of being conquered, part of coming in. They make the women do this. The Amish let you leave. In fact, they push you out for a year and say, maybe we don't want you. You know, when you're a teenager, right at that time to make your decision. It's not that way with the Islamists.
Push freedom. If you want to do that, then you should make that decision yourself and carry that out.
But we're not bad criticizing the burqas. No, we have that right, see?
We're criticizing the fact that women are being forced to do this, and many of them don't want to. In Iran, there's a huge campaign going on right now. Men in burqas or something like that is a hashtag. And men are actually putting on these outfits and letting the women dress in regular conservative clothing in support of this, pointing out the ridiculousness of this whole law in Iran.
Yeah, you know, we ought to have a day here, people want to opt into it, where we men all wear burqas on air, and we just cover our, and just see how it feels to be wearing a freaking Halloween mask.
4 hours of beef.
Finally get to wear a dress. Hey, Anthony Gucciardi, Biggs is going to ride shotgun with him, because I know you invited him to. He's got some other clips he's going to play and cover a bunch of news you've gotten ready for the show with. But since Biggs mentioned this, new international policing protocol. It's international. Our orders come from international, all these alphabet groups run by the same globalist. Don't link terror attacks to Islam or ISIS. Protocol 12 is beyond even what Obama says, which is official. When they're investigating a mosque, they can't say mosque, Islam, Muhammad. They can't ask those questions. Actually, there's like a list of 15 things. Well, now globalists use Protocol 12 to cover up jihadist attacks in the West, and they're just not even allowed to say it's Islamic. In fact, they can't even go investigate the Islamic centers, because it isn't Islamic. ISIS, that's the thing that has nothing to do with Islam.
The next time there's a terror attack, we should take the article that breaks down. We should take the article that breaks down all the information and black out with a Sharpie any kind of word like that, you know, Islam, this and that, and then just read it out and be like, you know, a man walked into a from a book.
Another 50 people were killed in Turkey today in a daily suicide bombing, but it has nothing to do with Islam.
Meanwhile, you know what's really powerful to watch is the video of the women who were freed from the Islamic State capture in whatever town they were in whatever country. And basically ISIS had taken over their little town. And they took off their burqas and they were burning them. And they were crying and they were like, oh my God, it feels so amazing.
Hey, that's enough of your white savior crap,
it's bad,
okay?
Right?
You're a white male. You're not allowed to talk. Shut up.
I know, but how dare we talk about this?
All evil founts from you, Gucciardi.
It does, actually.
But think about how many women out there despise that want to be able to have that freedom to choose what they want.
Look at these women burning these hot hoods they've got to wear.
I've had to wear that stuff before in some of these skits. It's not comfortable.
I mean, look at it. And then people say, well, it's their choice.
Completely free of the West where I felt safe.
You do a great AIDS Skrillex.
No, that's Carl the Cuck.
But you do the AIDS Skrillex earlier. That was on point.
I have to bend forward like a buzzard when I talk, though.
Carl the Cuck's hard.
Here, let me go ahead and try it. Here, hold on. Never go full elk shit as I'm about to do it. I hate the Western world. I want to crap all over Western values. I'm going to join ISIS. Yeah, me too. Oh, that'll be great. And me.
I think that was on point. I can tell you've watched it a few times.
Yeah. Are you kidding me?
We only watch it 5 times a day.
I know. It should be given to
it's
all children.
It's up there with gay fish.
Oh, I'm going to tell you. We watch gay fish a lot. I'm not trying to do a morning comedy show. At a certain point, I'm so serious, I like break down into gallows humor. And it's just going to get worse now. It's about 2 a.m. this morning, I can tell you. I'm thinking I'm going to go crazy today.
Today? You're going to get crazy today, huh?
We're going to have to go to the shine box.
Go to the shine box operation over here. I know. I'm all alone in this shine box over here.
All the secrets, Anthony.
I know. I revealed too much on this program today.
Now we're secretly getting orders from the Vatican?
Yes.
Or is it Israel today? The truth is, no one's getting any orders around here. That's why it's so bad and so good.
That's the problem.
How many orders are happening around here?
I'm told to, hey, what do you want to cover? And go cover it. You know, if you're going to talk about something or bring up something that's happening in the country, go shoot a report. Go talk about it. Give your viewpoint on it.
Meanwhile, other media is micromanaged because there's always a corporate message they want out.
Yeah. We literally do have more freedom here to cover the things we care about, to cover the things we want to cover these hot topics that are unfolding, the breaking news, without anyone standing over our shoulder.
If you want to randomly act like AIDS Skrillex, you can, and just suddenly say, ISIS, that's the group that has literally nothing to do with Islam.
When I cross the Rio Grande River, dress up like an ISIS jihadi, that's an idea that popped in my head, and I called Dio. I was like, do you think this is a good idea? He's like, go for it, do it. Show the open border.
Yeah, the only stuff we're really, like, original investigative reporting, where we're actually with sources and stuff, then we have to meet about that a lot and stuff, and we have to vet all that and make phone calls and things. But other than that, we're just doing commentary and analysis. We're going to come back. Stay with us.
The Empire's on the run. Alex Jones
and the GCN. We're going to Photoshop Teletubby antennas on top of those burkinis, though. It's happening right now. Nothing's going to stop us. We're putting it out. We have major breaking news here as we're live on the air at 2:33 Central Time. Just a few minutes ago, because we were getting ready to go to her speech as she was concluding it, Hillary Clinton in this big event that she's been talking about for so long, where she was going to expose Donald Trump, she came out with more half-truths, lies, innuendo, hypocrisy, where we've got all these videos of her saying, build a wall, build a fence, deport felons, deport illegals. She said it in the 90s. She said it in the 2000s. She said it in 2008, running against Obama. It's all lies about Trump. It's all twisted spin, half-baked BS. And then she did it to me. And I'm the big you don't say Alex Jones. You never say the name Alex Jones. They always say the one from Texas, which is so honorable. I'm known as the Texan, thank God. That's right, Slime. And we're here standing against you. We don't care. We're committed. But more and more, they have to speak the name that no one says. It's like in Lord of the Rings, he says Saruman. He goes, Sauron, say the name. I mean, they will not even speak it. I love it that they won't speak my name. In fact, this bums me out that Hillary, the arch criminal, is actually speaking my name. It loses some of the mystique to be the unspoken one. But let me get serious, because I'm going to respond to this live here on air right now. Hillary Clinton just minutes ago concluded, while we were live on air at 2:35 currently, Hillary Clinton just concluded her live speech where she was going to destroy the KKK kingpin, Donald Trump. The problem is, we have her saying one of her main mentors was Senator Robert Byrd, who was a Grand Dragon and a Supreme Cyclops and all these other stupid comic book names the KKK has for themselves.
Green bed sheets.
It's really weird. It's a gang. You think just black people and Mexicans or whatever have gangs? The KKK is a white gang, okay, of degenerates. I mean, everybody's got their own degenerates. And that's what's going on. So Trump has disavowed over and over again. She goes into that. She goes into everything else. She's saying, shut down Breitbart. I mean, these are open statements, very dangerous tyranny. And she goes on to say, it's what happens when you listen to the radio host Alex Jones, who claims that 9/11 and the Oklahoma City bombings were inside jobs. He said the victims of the Sandy Hook massacre were child actors and no one was actually killed there. Now, let's stop right there, because that's lies and twisted disinformation. I said the Saudi Arabian government helped fund 15 of the 19 hijackers, and I said that there was a congressional investigation in 2002 that found that Saudi Arabia quarterbacked the 9/11 attacks, and that bipartisanly, high levels of the government blocked that investigation and blocked the FBI from even stopping the hijackers before it happened because of the Saudi connection, and they basically stood down. Mm-hmm. Now, I was interviewing the whistleblowers and FBI people back in 2002, 3, 4, 5. I was having members of the CFR on and others, high-level former spy chiefs like Dr. Pechenik. I mean, I had my sources, but it was in the news that Saudi Arabia was involved. It just came back up with the 28 pages and has been proven correct. So they condense it down to like a Warner Brothers cartoon where I'm saying George W. Bush had the plunger blowing up the buildings. In fact, that's what Hardball always says. Jones says Bush literally had a detonator and like Wile E. Coyote blew it up. That's what they say. I didn't get that analogy from myself. They say that. I didn't say that. I said Bush was literally not even like the president. It was Dick Cheney. But it was much more sophisticated than that, and it's all come out. Now, let's talk about Oklahoma City. Let's talk about Oklahoma City. Oklahoma City was a total false flag with NATO, the ATF, and the CIA, and the FBI. And we know the names of the men from the witnesses in the building, from the police officers, and from the declassified information that came out, the bombs in the building. General Parton, the former head of Air Force Weapons, he went public about the bombs being inside, the outside being a diversion. It goes on and on and on. And so, yes, that was a false flag. And you ask, why do they use foreign agencies? That way they're all involved. Nobody can blackmail the others. And it's been declassified. The London Guardians reported the Germans have been caught doing bombings to blame right-wing groups as well as a national program in the 90s. They also, the British got caught leading the IRA. They actually led it from the top. The IRA didn't even know for decades. And it was the British government ordering the IRA to bomb to discredit the IRA. That is London Guardian, Associated Press, BBC. Look at it for yourself. So, yes, I do say that was a false flag completely. There's different types of false flags. And then they say that I say Sandy Hook massacre, that none of it happened. There have been top school safety experts that have come out and said that it's a cover-up. There have been major anomalies like Anderson Cooper using blue screen when he's not really at Sandy Hook. And we've seen CNN claiming that they were in Riyadh under Scud attack when they weren't. Remember, that's famous. I just said it should be investigated. Clearly, the whole story doesn't add up. Some people say it's all child actors. Some people say all this. That's not what I'm saying. There was a drill that day. A lot of weird stuff went on. So that's what I'm getting at here. Now, Joe Biggs was in here live in studio breaking down other news with us. We're going to go back to him in a moment and Anthony Gucciardi. But I wanted to go ahead, now that we have the clip, and play Hillary Clinton now planning to use Alex Jones as an attack on Trump. And again, this is meant to have him not use key ammo against Hillary, like, hey, there might be election fraud. Well, now the UN's coming to oversee the election saying there's going to be election fraud. Trump's been proven right again. We're covering real things, and she wants to illustrate this and act like none of it's happening.
The alt-right. She's scared of the alternative right news. That's what she's going after. She thinks that us being out here exposing all this, you know, she's trying to push this whole conspiracy thing to take away from the fact that we really are exposing criminal activity that's going on.
Well, sure, and they misrepresent. I mean, the truth is, I'm proud that I said there was something going on in 9/11, including the dust, and they now admit it was deadly, and they covered it up. I was right about that. I mean, this is common sense. Oklahoma City was totally a false flag. WorldNet Daily got the hotel receipts of the head of the FBI hostage rescue team there days before at you know, the hotel, and his whole team. He said he was in Dallas and didn't get there till that afternoon. I mean, we have it. We have the witnesses that saw him, identified him on TV. These guys were crazy enough to go plant bombs in the building and then go do press conferences at the bomb site. And the people that were working in the federal building were like, that's the guy planting the bombs. I've had all the witnesses on, Jane Graham, all of them. You know, I've had the cops on, the ones they didn't kill and torture to death. And you know who's running the show then? Within 10 minutes of the Oklahoma City bombing, who did Hitlery and Bill Clinton blame? Rush Limbaugh and talk radio. And then later, you know, Matt Drudge and everybody. They're coming after the press, folks, and they're scared of us. So they want to have this fake moral authority like they're up there on the high mountain going, and he talks to the kook, Alex Jones. And in the desert, he goes to an oasis and drinks good water. What a kook. See, that's why they admit now they want to censor us. And that's why they said Breitbart and other grassroots conservative media has no right to exist, because we're kicking your butt with the information, because it's the internet age. We can show you, say, build a wall 15 times and then say Trump's a bigot because he wants to build a wall. We can show what a fraud you are, lady. By the way, she looked like hell, like she was propped up during this press conference. Here it is. There she is, our
the Kennedy
queenie.
Assassination. Now, perhaps in Trump's mind, because Mr. Cruz was a Cuban immigrant, he must have had something to do with it.
Let's hit pause.
And there is...
Let's hit pause. No, his dad lived there. His dad was connected to serious organizations and groups. And you notice his dad, the whole thing got dropped a day later. See, all of it is a lie. See, we consider and analyze all of it. All of it is a lie. Now he doesn't like immigrants because Ted Cruz came from immigrants. No, we have the intel and we have... the girlfriend of Lee Harvey Oswald, who was CIA, saying, no, I knew Cruz. And then he's in photos. He's a very distinctive-looking guy. It looks like Rafael Cruz. And let me explain something. Most of the Cubans that came in the year before all that stuff kicked off, that's when Cruz came in, were working for the CIA. The CIA is bigger than Walmart and Coca-Cola combined, okay? I go to family reunions, and I'm not even proud of it because I built everything myself. Okay, it's not cool to be in the CIA. Okay, and my family, it's not like analyst and people and pencil pushers. It's like the Legion of Doom with eye patches, okay? And I'm not even proud of that. The point is that I know CIA when I see it, and that's Rafael Cruz. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, she's doing everything she can to divert the attention away from the emails, to divert the attention away from her failing health, and she's trying to use this to blame you, to blame Drudge, to blame Breitbart, and it's completely and totally pathetic. We have stacks and stacks of paper every day showing the criminality behind the Clinton Foundation, showing her failing health, showing that she doesn't have the ability to hold the highest office that we have in the U.S. as president. And she wants to attack you. That's like, it's such a low blow.
Well, it's because they're scared of the info. The reverse psychology, and Pachinik will agree with us, he's former top psyops of the State Department. I'm going to get him on tomorrow if he can come on. Let's get him on. Is that whatever they're really afraid of, they put out there like it's been discredited. It's a Jedi mind trick, you understand?
Yeah.
But Trump sees all that and is countermanding his staff continually, and that I can say that. I mean, look, Trump is on board. The problem is it's hard to find people at that level from the political class that aren't, you know, idiots, okay? But let's I'm sorry, I digress with her talking about Ted Cruz, because every line is just a load of disinformation. See, it took me 5 minutes just to decipher that steaming pile of horse manure. Let's go back to the source of the deception, the creature known as Hillary.
Of that. Just recently, Trump claimed that President Obama founded ISIS.
He said you did, too.
And he has repeated that over and over again.
Because you did, wench.
His latest paranoid fever dream is about my health.
And the giant diaper you're wearing.
And all I can say is, Donald, dream on.
Dream on. I see sickness.
He's been
your
taking
eyes.
Naps for the last 3 days.
Look at that barracuda, man. Look at that demon. Man, oh, man, I can't handle her.
Look at the bags under her eyes. The next...
She could literally star in the new Batman as a Joker. No makeup needed.
But my friends, this is what happens when you treat the National Enquirer like gospel. They said in October I'd be dead in 6 months. It's also what happens when you listen to the radio host Alex Jones, who claims that 9/11 and the Oklahoma City bombings were inside jobs. He even said, and this really just is so disgusting. He even said the victims of the Sandy Hook massacre were child actors, and no one was actually killed there. I don't know what happens in somebody's mind.
He's such a liar.
Dark their heart must be.
Wow.
To say things like that.
How dark my heart must be.
But Trump doesn't challenge these lies.
She loves my
heart. He actually went on Jones's show and said,
"Empire's never seen such giant
your reputation is amazing. I will not let you down."
Let's back her up. Man, I didn't know from the transcript she went on a whole rant about me. Back this up. Wow. My black heart. Hey, baby. Big, juicy, and red, and you know it. And not afraid. And that's what she can't stand. Wow, I was watching some of it earlier in the break, and she didn't look that animated and that angry. When she starts talking about me, she like, these people must be like, got the red button ready to pull the trigger on me. Just, oh, make me great? Oh, boy, just watered the tree. Boom, boom. I mean, I don't want to die, but let me tell you. Huevos Rancheros right here. I mean, I am born to bring you down, lady. So I'm a little bug, huh? Step on me. This is ecstasy, actually. I didn't say there was child actors. We've had guests that say that, had debates, and had the other guy that, you know, says it's all real on. We've had debates like CNN does, you know, people saying nothing happened and people saying it all happened. I mean, we've really got her here. Because now in Oklahoma City, I did say it's a stage. I mean, I know the names of the bombers. Would you like me to tell you? I've had the head of the canine squad that was there 2 minutes after. He knows all of them. They came to his office and said, "We're going to kill you." His name's Don Browning. He's in Oklahoma City. Decorated Marine Corps veteran and head of the canine unit. You don't want to talk to Don Browning that saw the NATO op, the FBI operator, the CIA operator, the ATF operator? And I got to hand it to these agencies. They had high-level guys, heads of departments stringing the gray sticks of butter. She's like, "What are you doing in the stairwell?" They're like, "Oh, telephone work, dear." And I remember she says, Jane Graham said, "I was struck by how handsome they were." And so she was like, "Well, what are you guys doing?" And she was, you know, I guess, and they were like, "I'm going to move along, sweetheart. We're doing some important work right now." Oh, and you had the deputy attorney general at the time running the operation. Sorry, let's back it up and go back to it. Here it is. Whenever we're ready. With Hitlery. Maybe we've lost audio, I'm not sure. We had audio earlier, but sometimes when you're doing these DVRs, they do this. Yeah, you guys got the audio?
Heart must be to say things like that. But Trump doesn't challenge these lies.
No, I want to back it up, guys.
He actually went on, Jones.
I want to back it up. Back it up to the start. Like, back it up a minute. That is the most, that is ambrosia. I mean, the liar, the criminal, the founder of ISIS that brought al-Qaeda into Syria, that murdered hundreds of thousands of Christians with her co-founder at the Legion of Doom, Obama, these horrible demons, and she's talking about my black heart. It's my heart is so big and red and juicy. I do this for love, lady. I don't do this to count a bunch of...
$30,000 a person per plate to come hang out with her.
Oh, my God. And it's not that I'm being recognized by them. I mean, they run Media Matters. They attack me every day now. They attack me all over the CNN, MSNBC. But to have the demon itself try to turn InfoWars into some weapon that's going to bring down Trump, when, of course, Trump's winning by a landslide. They are panicking. They are completely freaking out. Okay, do we have the DVR queued up now? Here we go. Here it is.
And he has repeated that over and over again. His latest paranoid fever dream is about my health.
Yeah, I must get the break. This will be a day long remember.
And all I can say is, Donald, dream on.
Young, got that smile. She looks like family members of mine after they've been dead a couple of days, laying on the slab. Those gums are coming back off those teeth, aren't they, sweetie? That soul wants to get out of there.
But my friends.
Man, I've got so much energy. I'm just power surging. I love God. I love sun.
I'm going to run up to her and give her an injection.
Friends,
here we go.
This is what happens when you treat the National Enquirer like gospel.
Oh, that said your husband was Monica Lewinsky?
They said in October I'd be dead in 6 months.
And you look like you are.
It's also what happens when you listen to the radio host, Alex Jones, who claims that 9/11 and the Oklahoma City bombings were inside jobs. He even said, and this really just is so disgusting, he even said the victims of the Sandy Hook massacre were child actors, and no one was actually killed there. I don't know what happens in somebody's mind or how dark.
I don't know.
How'd
you send ISIS in to kill all those Christians? I don't know.
To say things like that.
I didn't say that.
But Trump doesn't challenge these lies.
Trump
doesn't. He actually went on Jones's show and said, "Your reputation is amazing. I will not let you down."
They hate
this
that.
From the man who wants to be president of the United States. You know, I've stood by President Obama's side as he made the toughest decisions a commander-in-chief has to make.
When she said
in
my
times
name,
of crisis,
cheered.
Our country depends on steady leadership, clear thinking.
You don't look too steady, lady.
Because one wrong.
She said she needed a Parkinson's drug because she couldn't think clearly. We have your email, wench, and more is coming, more is coming. You can't stop any of us. You will fall. La, la, la.
She said she had a cracked head.
Oh, this is so good. Oh, this is so good. Look at her.
Tell the difference or doesn't
help
care
me,
between fact and fiction. And who buys so easily into racially tinged rumors.
I've been waiting for this a long time.
Someone so detached from reality should never be in charge of making decisions that are
this
real.
Is the best comment. I'm serious. Oh my
and
God, this is so good.
That is yet another reason why Donald Trump
look at her. She's
is simply temperamentally unfit to be president of the United States. Now, I hear and I read some people who are saying, well, his bluster and his bigotry is just overheated campaign rhetoric. An outrageous person saying outrageous things for attention.
I realize her spirit is so weak, and I don't but care what they do to me. I'm with a spirit that's good. I love it. Oh, it's so good.
Trump has proposed.
She says Trump's detached from reality.
Into practice. And don't be distracted
look
by
at our enemy. That's what they say in the Bible, and the devil's
waters.
Locked up for 1,000 years, so everybody can look at him. Everybody's going to say, this did all that?
But we know where he stands. He would form a deportation force to round up millions of immigrants and kick them out of the country. He'd
and kick them out of the country just like their countries do.
That says if you're born in the United States, you're an American citizen.
Hey, can we?
We got to take this clip and go back when she used to say the opposite.
Exactly. Oh, my God. She's targeting low information people, man.
Millions
oh, my God.
Of them. He'd ban Muslims around the world
let's turn it
from entering
off
our country.
I can't. Well, Anthony Gucciardi, you want to pop in here? I'm sorry. I feel 5 years younger, though. This is like a... They're into blood transfusions of children. I'm just into this.
Yesterday, Paul was tweeting out, wonder if Hillary Clinton will even mention this in tomorrow's alt-right speech. And sure enough, here you go.
Well, I'll tell you what. Number one.
The Death Star is orbiting the planet.
The Death Star
velocity.
Is orbiting the planet and ready to fire. Mm-hmm. Congratulations, because this means that they have tried all other options of ignoring you and everything you're
and
doing.
And now they've got to actually approach the Kraken
and
Doom.
And now they are issuing the Sauron statement, Voldemort, the one who will not be named because people will Google you. And I bet you look at the trends right now, it's just crazy and people are going to the website. And also, though, we have been
distracted.
They just
drank hemlock.
Check this out, though. We are debating her points. She can't debate our points, so she's taking things you didn't even say 15 years ago, skewing them, and then putting that up, right? So,
and now everyone will hear what I really said and agree
exactly.
with me.
Exactly. You need to challenge Hillary.
I mean, Anderson Cooper's up there with his face disappearing at Sandy Hook, with his, and I'm like, what the hell is this?
You have to do a breakdown and a thorough analysis of this.
You should do a response and challenge her to talk about all the things that you brought up instead of attacking you with ad hominem BS from 15-year-old twisted statements. If she actually could defend one thing you said, she would, but she can't, so she has to use
weird. Well, sure,
weird
no, she's giving
illusion.
Talking points to the media of what to go out and say I said.
Oh, of course, exactly.
And well, it's like I said that she has a tumor the size of a watermelon, and I said it was a joke. I said they're lying and saying Trump's behind the polls and dropping out. You know, it's not true. Like, it's not true if I say she has a tumor the size of a watermelon. And then they had articles saying Jones says she has a giant brain tumor. I mean, these people are just complete jokes.
Well, what happens if they can't actually argue with the real stuff you say? They have to say that you know, they'll take a picture of you doing a funny face or something. It's just standard BS,
it's the same
right?
thing when they
Well, they also do this. I've seen media say Jones has Nazi stuff behind him. It's Obamacare next to Hitler, punch Anthony back up, saying that's bad. But see, that's what they do.
Yeah, of course, because they can't actually argue with your points.
They can never even
can't have a discussion.
Did you hear Alex was with Hitler?
Yeah, well, it's the same thing when we go debate these social justice warriors at these events. They never have anything to say, but all they can do is say sexist, racist, Islamophobic, transphobic, and that's all they have. And all they can say against you is they go, Alex Jones, a conspiracy theorist, but they won't actually
You said, who's Alex Jones? And they go, we don't know. We were told by the people that paid us to be here.
But look, they're so dumb. They're stuck in the old system. She's like Frank Underwood from House of Cards. She's like an 80s politician. She doesn't understand the Streisand effect. She attacking you is going to make you bigger and stronger. Help me, I'm weak, right? And then you're going to actually come back with more content delivered to her. And all the people that are Googling you from her side saying, who is this global person? They're going to say, wow, actually, all of this makes sense. So it's 100% a victory, major success. She doesn't understand that those weighted words have no actual weight. It's all just weird things where she thinks she can say
3 days off.
Conspiracy, bad person.
She looks worse than ever, man. She looks drugged up. She looks like a corpse they're propping up.
She probably had to go through like a whole. Everyone who follows her is so dumb they're not going to look at
it. You know when those NBA players come off the court and everyone's like high-fiving them? She's going through and they're just jabbing her with shots to kind of boost her up so she can get to the stage. So she's like, all right,
she's an Iron Maiden of needles. She's an Iron Maiden with like 50 needles.
It's like when you go through basic training or whatever. Everyone's just like.
It's like in Mars Attacks when the Martians jump up to have the thing slam on them with their uniforms.
She starts off on a stool and they just give her enough injections or she can finally stand up. Like, take the pillows away. Let's go.
No, they just say Alex Jones a bunch of times and she gets so mad that she's able to finally have some energy and go on stage.
You're right. Web traffic is 3 times more than normal. But see, here's an example. What was it where it was like 15 times its record or something? That's when there's like a mass shooting or a bombing. People tune in for us. That's why she's not even that big. People tune in to hear what we have to say about an event.
Look, they know we're really trying to tell you the truth. This is it. Alex Jones triggered Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
There you go.
This is it. Oh, you get a thug life. Where's your thug life?
You triggered her. Yeah, Biggs did good. He triggered like an immigrant over. You triggered Hillary Clinton. I think that deserves the thug life category.
Well, we can do a heyday with this because we can show like the news going Saudi Arabia involved, government stood down, like ABC News, and then cut to me like 10 years ago saying it, and they cut Hillary going, he says 9/11, and then like experts say there were bombs inside the building of Oklahoma City, and cut to me, he said Oklahoma triggered, and then it just goes down the line. All right, we're out of time.
What difference does it make?
Support us, purchase the products, we're independent media, we don't have globalists funding us, just like Trump doesn't. The new Selenium is back in stock, goes great with the X2, InfoWarsLive.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139 and get your Hillary for prison shirts and Bill Clinton rape shirts exclusively at InfoWars.com. Oh dear, I'll have to disintegrate you, pesky earth creature.